There it is.
Okay, I got it.
Going to 26?
Okay. Irish down just a little more. That should be good right there.
Okay, perfect. Where do we go to the national anthem, or what do we do?
Our open will be going over the anthem.
Oh, I got you. So we don't talk to once we come back.
So we're back live. That's right. That whole thing we just recorded gets rolled.
Okay, we're live. Are we live? The stream is live. 2 minutes.
Tonight, it's an American Conference showdown in New Orleans. UConn, a perfect 6-0 to start the season. A main reason, getting it done on the mound. The Huskies, fifth in the nation in strikeouts. Tulane, they've won their first two conference series. Their big reason, swinging the bats. Hot pitching versus hot hitting. Who will win tonight? We'll find out next on the American Digital Network. It's an American Conference showdown this evening in New Orleans. First place UConn taking on Tulane. Hello, everybody, and good evening. It's Gus Kattengell along with Ron Svoboda. We welcome you to Greerfield Church and Stadium. And, Ron, it's a heck of a matchup between two teams with hot starts. Tulane has won its first two series. UConn undefeated in conference play.
Yeah, chance for the Green Wave to pick up some ground, but you're playing a good team, playing well.
Well, for both teams to continue to play well, these key features today, meaning key plays.
Yeah, Tulane's going to see a really power arm in Tim Cate, the sophomore left-hander, starting for the Huskies. He's a guy that strikes out a lot of people. His fastball will get into the low to mid-90s, and a curveball that may break your heart. Mm-hmm. So you're going to have to be patient against him, try to get ahead. For UConn, their team doesn't hit a whole lot of home runs, unlike Tulane, who almost lives by the long ball. But they've got to get guys on base, be patient at the plate, and they like to use the bunt a lot, and they'll use it offensively. They get on base, they're going to run on you if they can. So you're going to have to play small ball when UConn's at the plate.
Well, UConn's had a good start as a team, but Zach Susie's had a heck of a start as a player himself.
Yeah, you know, he's their catcher. He doesn't look like a catcher. He's lean and mean, but right. Here's a guy hitting 348 or something in that neighborhood. 40 base hits, 31 runs driven in. I think if you look up and down their lineup, he's a guy you should choose not to let beat you.
And for the Tulane Green Wave, Grant Witherspoon, right at the top of the lineup, has been key so far this season for the Green Wave.
Oh, interesting sophomore in a lineup full of seniors. He came through Cincinnati, Tulane's second weekend of conference play, rolling 8 for 18, 9 RBIs. He's starting to do it. He's hitting at 321, right at the top of your order where you need to make things happen.
So basically, good hitting versus good pitching tonight. We'll see who gives in. First pitch and lineups coming up next on the American Digital Network.
This is a classroom. This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Hi, welcome back to Greer Field, Turchin Stadium in New Orleans. UConn, Tulane getting set to get underway. An absolutely gorgeous evening. Ron Sroboda, Gus Cattingill with you. And Ron, as you can see on the mound, a pitcher for the Tulane Green Wave, a left-hander, and Sam Youngyeld, who's going to be very important tonight to the chances of the Green Wave being able to pull out a win.
Yeah, you're reaching a little for your pitching here. One of the problems for Tulane has been pitching's been a little thin. They haven't comfortably had three guys for Friday, Saturday, Sunday going. Bjorn Gjeld will probably be asked to, you know, if things go well, he'll be out there for 75 pitches. He's thrown five innings one time this year. Most of his other work has been short-term, out of the bullpen. But he's getting to start tonight. You'll see a fastball, mainly a four-seamer that he uses, tops out around 88. He'll use his curveball and his changeup, more changeups against the right-handed hitters, obviously.
Yeah, no doubt. And as when you take a look at it here, the UConn starting lineups, they start out with Anthony Prado over at shortstop, Willie Yawn at third, and there he is, Zach Soucy in the three-hole at the catcher position, but really kind of getting that offense going.
Yeah, you know, we said it in the open, Soucy's a guy if... you know, if he can beat you and you've got a base open, you might want to pass him.
So getting set to get going here. Again, UConn a perfect 6-0 on the season. Ron, if you have to lose a conference series, the Tulane Green Wave have won their conference series. And now we'll see. Good hitting, good pitching as we start the game. Anthony Prado, first batter up, sees a pitch down the middle for strike by Youngyeld.
Yeah, I think for everybody in the Green Wave dugout who have really done a great job of turning around what was an unmitigated disaster early
on. Second pitch is hit right down the field, right, and goes foul. It was taken
to the
right.
There, but you know, they were 2-12 out of the gate in a streak. Mm-hmm. Tulane was, and that's coming out of the chute on your hands and knees. They've really put it back together and playing like an entirely different group.
Ahead in the count here, ground ball the second. Now be fielded by Will Z. Picks it up and in time for the first early out. How important is it to get a quick start against a team that you know is going to have a good pitcher when Kate gets on the mound for the Huskies?
Yeah, I think, you know, really you're going to see probably as good an arm out there. And they've got a couple of guys they can throw at you, but Kate will be one of those guys that will challenge you. So for Bjorn Gjeld, he's, you know, can keep his stuff down. You know, he can use his fastball up, but he's got to locate it.
Third baseman Willie Yawn now at the plate for UConn. He sees the first pitch in there for a strike as well. And I got to mention, you mentioned with Bjorn getting a good start, an easy start would be getting in and out of that inning early as Yawn gets a base hit over to left field. So runners on here in the second at bat for the Huskies?
Yeah, you're really just concentrating on making quality pitches. You know, baseball sort of happens. You know, that was a breaking ball that he went down and got. Not that bad a pitch, but a good piece of hitting by the junior, Willie Yawn.
Well, here he is, Zach Soucy. You mentioned him in the open.
Now you know, at least you're lefty against his left-handed bat.
Batting .348 on the season. And excuse me, swing the third over to second for one and not in time as the throw pulls the first baseman Hunter Williams towards home plate. But Tulane does get the out at second. Kind of one of those didn't really mean there. Good pitch by Bjorn Gjeld to kind of get him to make that That swing.
See, he threw him a breaking ball. He tried to check his swing, but got a piece of it. Not a ball you're going to double somebody up on, but they tried.
So the fielder's choice gets him over to first base. Two out in the inning here. As that'll bring up Isaac Feldstein, the right fielder for UConn, a junior.
Got that Old Testament name. You got like, we got an Isaac Galloway on the baby cakes this year. He's been with us for a couple.
Second pitch swung on and fouled off behind home plate. Even with the base hit, other than that, I've seen Bjorn yelled here in the first inning, kind of get ahead of hitters, throwing, locating, getting strikes. Always a nice early sign that you're looking at from the dugout.
Yeah, I think they've been pretty comfortable with what he's given them lately on the mound.
Ground ball to third. Hunter Hope with a chance to get the wave out of the inning. The throw is in time. So other than the base hits by Willie Yawn over the left field, Tulane escapes without giving up a run. When we come back, we will definitely see a pitcher that the Tulane Green Wave have talked about a lot today. Tim Cate, as the Huskies take to the field next.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Welcome back to New Orleans. The Tulane Green Wave getting ready to have their first at-bat of the game. Gus Cattingill, Ron Sloboda with you. A base hit by the Huskies in the top of the first. And now they take to the mound and to the field. And on the mound, Ron, Tim Cate, a pretty good pitcher for the Huskies.
Yeah, you're going to see pretty much power stuff from him. He's got a fastball that can challenge you. Upper 80s, actually into the low 90s. 94 he might top out at. What they call a 12-6 curveball right over the top that's got some bite to it and a changeup behind all of that. He's a guy that has struck out 44 hitters this year in his 30 innings of work.
But we'll get into the UConn pitching staff right now with the amount of strikeouts. Fifth in the nation. We'll give you that total here in a second. But, Ron, the Tulane Green Wave the last five games, batting .350. And their batting average as a team has gone up 45 points, as you see the starting lineups there. Only two batters, though, above .300. But Grant Witherspoon really leading the way, and he's going to lead off the right fielder.
You know, and it's almost like those total numbers are not really the story. The story is, what have you done for me lately?
Right.
And these hitters for Tulane have been making better contact, putting the ball in play hard. I came to Nichols State a couple of nights ago. They hit four balls out of the yard and a couple of wall balls to boot. So they are really, as a team, swinging the bats so much better.
So the lefty-lefty battle starts with the first pitch just outside for a ball. An absolutely gorgeous evening here. You can look at the flags in center field blowing from right to left, Ron, a 79-degree evening. It's absolutely gorgeous. Not very humid. You were down there talking to the coaches, and you don't look like you needed to change your shirt there. The second pitch is fouled on and fouled back.
It's comfortable. It's optimal baseball weather, and that was a fastball up that Witherspoon fought off. But, yeah, the wind is blowing out to left field. That may come into play.
But Tulane against Nichols hit a couple of home runs. We'll get to that here in a quick second as the 1-1 pitch is thrown and an off-speed pitch down low. They hit a couple of home runs against Nichols State.
Yeah, Nichols had a little trouble getting their breaking ball over. They fed them a few fastballs, and Tulane launched big time. They've hit 35 home runs this year, the Green Wave have.
Witherspoon ahead 2-1, and he pops up over to first base. Winkle calls off Lambrecht, and that will be the first out of the inning.
Yeah, a little semi-collision between Doyle Scooters, the first base umpire. He was trying to get around behind Winkle, and they bumped a little bit. Doug Williams is at home plate, the umpire. Eddie Newsom at third base. Three umpires tonight. One out for the Greenway.
Second straight left-hander going up to the plate for the Tulane Green Wave, Lex Kaplan, their left fielder.
Yeah, three out of your first hitters against a tough left-hander are left-handed.
And the first pitch for him is swung on, popped up, left center, still going back and almost to the wall, and it's off the glove of John Topa. Looked like he had a beat on it, and we mentioned the win. Ron, it almost seemed like Topa thought that it was going to be a shallow pop up to left, and you noticed all of a sudden he got on his horse and the ball wound up landing over in the warning track.
Well, Lex probably thought he hit it out of here, but you know, the first thing you do as an outfielder when you come into a new park, look where the wind is blowing, and that's going to change the way balls come to you, how much they carry. He was drifting, thinking he might be catching up to this one. He did not.
All right, so Hunter Williams, the first baseman for the Green Wave, steps up to the plate. 365, one of two batters for the Green Wave, Ron, that is hitting above 300.
He's really been solid all year long. This guy's a senior, 4-0 average. Talking about med school, if he doesn't go play baseball for money, and he gets the respect of a first-pitch curveball.
Yeah, he went for the money swing there, trying to make it 2-0. Swung on and missed right through it there. Kaplan at second with the double there.
Yeah, he's been really solid for him, really their best hitter.
Second pitch popped up to center field. Krueger under it, coming in, makes the catch as his hat comes off, and Kaplan will make his way back over to second.
Got in his kitchen a little bit, had him fight it off. So these are not optimal sight conditions right now. You know, this sort of twilight before right. The lights in the stadium
take. Now, the
take
sun
over.
Is setting over towards behind the bleachers on third base. So it's not really in anybody's eye other than maybe the right fielder and first baseman. But the ball is going to be coming from a different direction. So, but you're talking about more about picking up the ball from home plate with the lighting.
Yeah, you know, the contrast is not there. The lights in the stadium haven't taken over. It's a little hard to see right now.
Tulane's designated hitter now at the plate, Jarrett DeHart. Trying to knock in Lex Kaplan at second. The Huskies in the top of the first inning got a hit.
And DeHart's done a good job for him this year.
Here's the pitch and swung on and fouled over behind third base. So the Huskies, Ron, got a runner on, but Bjorniel was able to get out of that inning here. And again, with Tim Cates, look, 7 1/3 innings, 13 strikeouts last week, 2 hits, a walk. And the first hit didn't come into the 5th inning, so already Tulane doing more against Cate than the opposing team from a week ago.
Yeah, but if you don't convert here, you haven't done anything. DeHart leading them in RBIs with 31.
The pitch swung on. It'll be a grounder to second, and the Huskies should get out of the inning, and indeed they do. Lambrecht getting it over to Winkle, and at the end of one, we have no score. New Orleans just underway. The Huskies in first place, the Green Wave in a tie for second. We'll give you those standings where we come back next on the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
Easter weekend in the series. I normally start on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, starting a day early across the country. Gorgeous evening, just under 80 degrees as the sun sets. Folks wearing the shorts and enjoying an American Conference Showdown, UConn 6-0 in conference play, 19-11 overall, 15-18 overall for the Tulane Green Wave, 4-2 in conference play. As the top of the second will be led off by the right fielder, Isaac Feldstein. Gus Cattingale, Ron Svoboda with you. As in the first inning, Huskies got a hit but failed to get him in. The Green Wave got a double, failed to get them in. So, Ron, in the first inning, both teams getting a runner on base. Huskies didn't get him in running position. Tulane did, but neither team able to get a run over in the beginning as we get a ground ball over the George Cougar. The runners on first and second, Ron.
Yeah, Kruger, a guy who's played a little bit more, but he's from the left side. Bjorngeld maybe wants to throw him a breaking ball.
First pitch
ball.
To him is high and outside, and that's going to bring out Gazzo, the catcher for the Tulane Green Wave. They have a little chat here. Bjorngeld able to get out of the inning in the first with UConn only a runner on off of a single. Here, a single in the walk.
Bjorngeld went 5 3rd innings back on March the 22nd, and that was against Louisiana Lafayette. In the last five appearances, he's only gone 2 innings, 3 innings, 1 3rd innings his last time out.
Finds the strike zone there at the second pitch to make it even, 1-1.
He should be in shape to go. We mentioned 75 pitches. That's not a drop-dead total. That's right. Just sort of an idea.
Just over the 20-pitch mark at 22. Here's the 1-1. Down the middle and fouled over to the left side. So ahead in the count here. Do you go with the hard stuff, little change up here, little breaking stuff? Or
if you felt confident throwing him a breaking pitch with a 1-2 count, you've got room to do it here. And, you know, let's face it, in college baseball or almost anywhere else, if you throw a decent breaking ball, it's never a bad idea.
Defense for the Green Wave straight on. Here's the 1-2 pitch, and it is.
A big snake that hangs high in the zone or out of the zone. He tried to break one off on him.
Didn't break, really.
Left it up there a little bit.
So 2 balls and 2 strikes. It's Keith Kruger batting .243 on the season. He has 18 hits, 8 RBIs, looking for RBI number 9, and he throws the bat at it. He rolls it weakly over to third. It'll be a foul.
It's a little harder breaking ball that Bjorngeld will change speeds on his breaking ball. It may, the curveball he left high, that's a little harder. Looks like a slider. That was a pretty good pitch.
It moved, and Kruger able to stay alive.
He did a great job of keeping this at-bat active.
So back we go, 2 balls, 2 strikes. 2 outs as well in the top of the second. Next pitch is swung on and fouled again over to the left side. So 2 foul balls, 3 actually, over on that side. What does that tell you as a hitter, Ron, when you're out there? You've hit 3 foul balls that gone that way. It seems to me like they're going to the outside part of the plate.
Well, he's pitching your way, and really, Kruger's just doing his job of staying alive. He hasn't had anything very good to hit yet, but they've been strikes or close to strikes.
Gazzo waiting for the 2-2 and the breaking ball a little high, and it'll be 3 balls and 2 strikes.
Now you got
so
the
staying
guys
away.
There'll be action on the bases with 2 outs and a 3-2 count.
The ball here, Ron, just didn't break down, stayed up, crossed around the chest.
If he gets it for a strike, he's got him, but he unfortunately left that slider up, that harder breaking ball up there.
The Huskies on first and second will get a head start here on the 3-2. Bjorngeld delivers, and it's a single to left field, and coming up and throwing is Lex Kaplan. The play of the plate will not happen. It will be cut off by Hunter Hope, and an RBI for Keith Kruger as the Huskies jump out ahead 1-0. An RBI single to left, and it goes back to that at-bat where he stayed alive, Ron, and was able to fall off a couple of pitches so he found something that he could drive and really just went with the pitch. They pitched him outside. He went over to left field.
Yeah, he left that breaking ball up. It didn't have a whole lot on it. Wasn't doing a whole lot. And he did a great job just serving it softly over the shortstop's head. That'll get a run in. Top of the order.
John Topaz comes on in to score. And the first pitch to Anthony Prado. And for a ball as well. So still runners on first and second for UConn. Spioniel delivers inside. Fastball there for a strike.
Almost looks like he cuts that fastball a little bit. You do that, you can get it in on those right-handers. You create that sense in there if you're a right-handed hitter against Bjornjell that that fastball is something you can't contend with. You can pitch off of that.
Unless Prado. I was going to say Prado grounded out to second in his first at-bat just an inning ago.
Yeah, I was talking about, you know, a pitcher trying to use success with one pitch on one side of the plate to be able to pitch you effectively on the other side of the plate.
Next pitch grounded right up the middle and not able to get it is Cody Hosey. In the center field it goes. Play goes back to second. He is out before the run comes in. Now the umpire is saying he's safe there at home.
Yeah, that's a run. He's in.
So the run is coming in. I thought that got tagged out at second. And that would stop it.
That was a good pick by Grant Brown. Caught the runner. This ball goes through the infield. Grant Brown charging hard. Look, he catches the runner taking the big turn. He is tagged out at second base.
So that'll end the second inning there for UConn as they lead 1-0. Tulane coming to bat in the bottom of the second on the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
There you go, the Eric Lane Wall of Champions there.
Yeah, I knew Eric Lane, and what a great guy he is.
So the run did not score there.
That was
close. So it stays 1-0 as the tag at second was made before that. That'll bring up for the Tulane Green Wave, Hunter Hope, the third baseman.
That's a real good play by Grant Brown. To pick that runner off a
second.
That's
a huge defensive play to keep it 1-0 there. The first pitch.
He would have been in a lot better.
Kate, there's a ball.
Would have been better for the runner to get caught in a rundown.
Right.
And not get out right away.
Might have been not even a half a second. You saw the home plate umpire.
I had a hard time looking in both places, to be honest with you.
Doug Williams did the safe sign, saying, I guess, wave it off. The run did not come in as the tag at second happened quick, I guess. You make the decision there. Grant Brown can't get him at home. Try to throw it back at second, and it worked. It's a big play.
He made the play he had. And it saved you a run.
For Hope, the count's 1-1. Still has the sunglasses on as the sun is starting to set. The 1-1 inside for a ball.
Hunter Hope is a guy that, you know, he's probably about 6 or 7 strikeouts away from setting an NCAA record for 3 years of varsity baseball in the nation. But he has really gathered himself and put his at-bats back together. He really struggled. The third baseman, but he's really come on strong. And you always feel for a guy that has to battle like that because it was pretty frustrating for him early in the year.
Tim Cade, a beautiful curveball to make it 2-2, and now it's a pop up over to first, and Winkle will be able to pull that away. So Hunter Hope flies out. to the first baseman. So from the UConn dugout, Ron Svoboda, this is what they're seeing.
Yeah, they're like, they probably all have their sunglasses on. They took them off their hats so they could watch the game. But
well, Chris Winkle had to battle that just now to get that pop up.
This is a little tough when the throw comes from third base to first base if it's a little high.
Shortstop Cody Hester, first pitch swinging deep into center field. Going back is Keith Krueger and tracks it down on the warning track. You saw the flag there as the ball was making its way over the center.
Well, he started
going a little bit to the left. It's good swing.
He banged it hard, but
deepest
there was
part of the ballpark there at 400.
Room for Krueger in center. He used all of it here, as you see. That's a fastball squared up pretty good by Hosey.
See the flag blowing right to left. It started tailing a bit.
Yep. That's a long ride out there.
That's just enough maybe to keep it from going straight out, huh?
Yeah, I think, you know, like anything, he's not a big power guy.
Grant Brown, first pitch swinging as well in the right field, is going to fall for a base hit for the Green Wave.
Atta baby. Well, he made a good play back a half an inning ago, and he contributes a two-out base hit.
Grant Brown, yeah, I was going to say, responsible for keeping it 1-0 and able to get...
Fastball down the middle. Interesting he goes the other way because he gets a great job of getting his hands inside that one and shoots it to right field.
When you have a pitcher that Tim Cate is, it is maybe part of a game plan as a hitter to go up there first pitch swinging, thinking that maybe that's going to be your first pitch there?
Well, I think you want to hit off a good pitch first. You know what I'm saying? Don't let him get ahead of you. But right. But you got to go up there thinking, if it's a strike, I'm letting this thing go. So be ready to hit, but let your eyes tell you no. You know, don't swing at his pitch early on. You know, if he makes a great pitch, even if it's a strike, you would like to not swing at it.
First plate appearance for second baseman Jake Wilsey. The first pitch to him there for a strike. Two outs here in the bottom of the second inning. UConn leading it. 1-0, four hits, no errors.
Wilsey's a guy, too, who was flat scuffling early offensively. That 196 may not thrill you, but he has done a great job of putting his offensive thing back together. You know what? You go back six or seven games, he's hitting about 149. he's done a great job of hanging in there. He's had... five hits in his last four games. Seven hits in his last nine games. That's putting it together.
Grant Brown over at first, following a single to right. 0-for-2 on the season, trying to steal. And for the second straight pitch, Wilsey fouls it off. Little heat on the outside corner there. So he's in the hole 0-2 with two outs here in the bottom of the second inning. First place UConn, 6-0 in conference play. And for the Tulane Green Wave, 4-2 conference play. Trying to match UConn's run. Wilsey could not hold up, swing and miss. Catcher will pick it up and throw it on over to first. Winkle grabs it. Zach Soucy makes the throw. And we are done two here in New Orleans. UConn leads it 1-0 on the American Digital Network.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
Welcome back to New Orleans. UConn, first place in the American Conference, picking up where they left off a season ago, the conference champion, second in four seasons. Ron Svoboda, May 22nd, down 6-2, a five-run eighth to win and eliminated Tulane 7-6. It got him into the title game against Houston. You see the final out there and really just kind of picking up where they left off last season.
Yeah, this is, you know what, this is a team that's been together for a while. Tim Cate got the win in the regional. He beat Georgia Tech after this game. It's funny. You look at this coaching staff, right. Jim Penders, all his assistant coaches, Jim Penders' dad, his uncle, everybody's gone to UConn. It's, you know, they joke about it. It's like a cult. these guys go to school together. They stay together. Now they're working together as a staff, all of them Huskies, for a long, long time.
I'll bring up Willie Yawn, one for one on the day. He got a single over to left field, and he faces Beyond Yale, and the first pitch to him is low and outside for a ball. He had a solid stroke over to left field. And as first to bat back in the first inning, game moving along, top of the third inning. Second pitch to him, fouled off and swung on for foul. Zach Susie in the on-deck circle. Here's the 1-1, and it is high for a ball.
Yeah, it's been kind of interesting if you look at what you expected. So far, it's what you would expect. They've put the ball in play. They're a little better contact team day in and day out than Tulane. Tulane better with the power and almost hit one out in the first.
Bjorn yelled 3-1 here, swung on and fouled. Full count. First inning gives up a hit to UConn. Second inning, a great play by Grant Brown to keep it 1-0, but in some trouble there. How important is it for this to be a short inning for Bjorn Yale, or at least one that's a positive one?
Yeah, he's going to the heart of their lineup, too. So this is a bunch of guys that are going to challenge you and make you pitch. By that, I mean they're not going to go easy.
Right. Well, we saw the first run for UConn come after their batter fouled off several pitches to stay alive. A couple of foul balls here and swung on in another.
Yeah, these
are
guys.
Foul ball to the right side.
I think these are guys that have had a look at you. Mm-hmm. And maybe their attack is starting to coalesce in their minds. You know, hitters do that all the time after they get a degree of recognition.
Willie on, was that four? Straight foul balls over to the right side, staying alive. Does it get frustrating as a pitcher? Do you just have to go after every pitch and not worry about it? Or does it get to a point where you're like, it keeps falling? Maybe you try to do a little bit too much.
Well, when you're a pitcher who doesn't strike out a whole lot of guys, then, you know, you're trying to pitch to contact. He makes a great pitch there with a breaking ball.
Yawn grounds over to Hope, who makes the throw in time over to first to retire Willie Yawn, who earned his at-bat there.
Yeah,
and he'll bring in Zach Susie.
He had some stuff to swing at, but you see that breaking ball there was quality. Got it down under his hands. He rolls it to the third baseman, and just good job by the left-hander, Bjorn Jones.
Zach Susie 0 for 1 on the day. First pitch to him is high and outside for a ball. Grounded out to third. A lot of action being seen already by Hunter Hope over on the left side.
Yeah, I think he knows he better stay heads up. On this turf, too, is interesting because this is a new field put in by the new head coach, Travis Jewett. And it is AstroTurf with a sand base, about 70% sand worked into the fiber, and then some granulated rubber on top.
Oh, well, Bionio quickly gets behind 3-0.
While we're talking.
Here to Zach Susie.
Yeah. Maybe what he's trying to do is pitching too fine, and in the process you lost him.
Outside on the corner. The home plate umpire, Doug Williams. Ron wants it to hit the white part of the plate. If you're a Tulane fan, if you're a Husky fan, he's calling it perfectly. As Susie will make his way over to first base, Isaac Feldstein, right fielder.
15th walk for Susie.
First pitch to him, ground ball and to the left.
Good, he took a little something off of that one. Like to roll it to the infield. Interesting thing about this diamond that you don't see in many others is that there is no dirt on this diamond, though it looks like it.
It's all turf. Some that do have the artificial surface still do have real dirt on the infield. Here's the 0-1 pitch, and it's a ground ball. And guess who? It's the third baseman, Hunter Hope, making a solid throw after having to charge it. Winds up making that throw, Ron, almost on the right part, really, of the mound.
Yeah, he gave a quick look at second base and realized maybe that the sure play was at first base, and he took that on the run.
Two outs here in the inning. That'll bring up the designated hitter, Tyler Nesda, 0 for 1 on the day.
Nesda grounded out to shortstop, and last time up, but
you know, you're UConn. You do what you can do, and that little slow roller gets a runner to second base with two gone.
John Topaz is on deck. He got a hit. Got that RBI. Here's the first pitch, and it swung on and fouled off behind home plate. Again, a lot of pitchers starting to come up there. You said somewhere around, what, 70?
Yeah, 75 was the number.
We're at 47.
I didn't get the sense that it was a drop-dead number. When they say a drop-dead number, you don't go beyond that. Because he went, as I said, a while back, he went five innings.
That's the 282 on the season. Nice. The off-speed pitch there.
The breaking ball called strike against Nesda. It's up in the zone. You would think that's one you'd want to pick on.
So no balls, two strikes. Be big for Bjorniel to get out the inning here. Huskies looking to tack on, leading 1-0. Here's the pitch. Fastball outside. You saw the nod there by Paul Gazzo towards the pitcher. Said, hey, look, that's where I wanted it. That's fine, even though it was outside. He hit where he wanted him to go.
Yeah, I think what he did is show him a fastball and maybe you want to come back with something off speed.
1-2 to Nesda. Swung on and it's ground ball to Cody Hosey. But a first and the green wave get out of the jam there. So in the inning, saw a walk and no runs given up. Bottom of the third coming up next for Tulane on the American Digital Network.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Sun starting to set. As the light's starting to take an effect, Gus Kattengill, Ron Sroboda. Back over in New Orleans, Greerfield Turchin Stadium. The Huskies looking to remain perfect in conference play, 6-0.
We're having fun.
Having defeated East Carolina and Memphis, the Tulane Green Wave, 4-2 in conference play. Their conference wins. Ron, coming against Cincinnati in USF, at the time ranked 25th in the country. UConn this week moving into the polls.
Yeah, they get some mention.
The Huskies are 25th.
And what's good thing for Tulane, they beat South Florida 2 out of 3 in their first week of conference play. And those guys were ranked 25th in one of the polls in college baseball. Here's Tim Cate.
Third inning of work for him. Paul Gazzo, the Green Wave catcher, swings on and fouls it straight back. His first at-bat of the game. Gazzo, 266 on the season.
Of the Connecticut Gazzo brothers. They came from Connecticut. I asked Sal, his brother, who's an infielder, if they had gotten any interest from UConn, but it didn't appear it was much. So they'd like to beat him. That breaking ball in there for a strike. Give you some idea what kind of guy this left-hander Tim Cate is. In high school, he had Tommy John surgery. His left elbow was out of business.
Here's the 0-2. Swung on and fouled, and we'll do it again.
They came to look at him, the coaching staff at UConn. They saw him out in center field. He was playing in a ball game, throwing right-handed because he wanted to play baseball. You know? It reminds me a little bit of Jeremy Montalbano, the injured catcher for the Green Wave who got hurt at home plate earlier in the season. He's the kind of kid that would play through that as best he could.
0-2 to Gazzo, fouls it off again, second straight pitch.
Montalbano last year had a Tommy John injury.
Right.
Before he had surgery, he just said, wrap it up, I can still swing the bat. He went to DH and finished the season. That's tough. He told me before the game, Jeremy did, that he might be a week or so away from being able to get out there and do something.
A big pickup for the Greenway for that to happen.
That would be huge if it could happen. As he's such a, I told him the way your attitude, I said, if you were in a wheelchair with that injured ankle, I said, you probably want him to wheel you out to the mound and pitch out of the chair.
Tim Cate's 25th pitch of the night is singled over to right field. So Paul Gazzo leading off the bottom of the third inning.
Nice.
Single to right field. That'll bring up Grant Weatherspoon. Top of the order to right fielder for the Green Wave. Ron, UConn, fifth in the nation, averaging 10.1 strikeouts per nine innings, 272 through the 26 games. Tim Cate last week had 13 strikeouts. Well, I look up and down my score sheet. I only see one so far today.
Tulane's done a good job. And, you know, of course, you're facing a team that's figured out how to make a little bit better contact of late.
Weatherspoon's first pitch in there. Inside part of the plate for a strike. Only two hitters on the Tulane starting lineup today, Ron. Batting above 300. Weatherspoon is one, batting 321. The other is Hunter Williams.
But if you look at their last 5 to 10 games, this is a different offense than early.
Next pitch, fastball on the outside corner. Thought by a second there, by the way Doug Williams popped up, he was going to call a strike. Didn't. Yes, not much room on the outside of either side of the plate from blue behind home plate for either team tonight. One ball, one strike.
Well, you got a guy with some command on the mound, too. When you have command, you're going to get more calls.
Breaking ball, swung on to second. Over to second for one, and Prado will hold on to it as Lambrecht will throw out
4-6. Yeah, 4-6, the fielder's choice. Witherspoon, who has speed, is on first base. Not the worst thing that could happen to you.
Slowly hit over the second. Make sure you get that one out.
He had a good swing at a curveball there. So you don't feel so bad. I feel like Tulane is doing what we said they had to do. Command their at-bats. And don't get in great big holes against this left-hander.
Lex Kaplan now at the plate for the Greenway. First pitch to him is a curveball high.
Here's a guy, one of the seniors early on, who was just struggling at home plate. Him, Hunter Hope at third, Wilsey at second base. You had a bunch of guys that just weren't getting it done, and they were seniors, and you're dependent on them. And I just think been a lot of coaching changes. You think if you're a senior, you've seen four coaches here, counting one interim, and that's a lot of change. That gets in your head a little bit. You have a new coaching staff comes in with their own ideas about things, and that's a rough adjustment for guys to make. It looks to me like they've come to a little commonality of minds here.
Cate's next pitch is swung on and fouled. Well, it's a base hit over to right field. Down into the corner, grounding third and being told to stop is Witherspoon. And in the second is Lex Kaplan.
Well, Kaplan's one of those guys who's been on fire, and he's hit his second double of the ball game. And now
back-to-back doubles for Kaplan.
Now you got a little something going with Hunter Williams, a right-hander coming up next with only one out.
Cate's fastball down the middle there.
See how he pitches Hunter Williams with a base open.
So one out here in the bottom of the third inning. UConn leads it 1-0. Runners on second and third for the Green Wave. But Hunter Williams, the first baseman up, flied out to center in his first at bat. Cate in his first bit of real trouble here. As
here we go.
Williams is going to single. It will drop into center field. The throw cut off at first. One run in, and right behind Witherspoon is Kaplan.
That's what you call a really good read by the man at second base. Lex Kaplan saw that soft line drive that it was going to fall. Once he had a good read on it, off he goes. He's got a little bit of speed. They were trying to hold him up. Look, he ran through a stop sign and scores standing up. Check that out to take the lead 2-1.
Off to the mound for a visit with Tim Cate. Remember last week, Tim Cate, 7 1/3 inning, 13 strikeouts, gave up just 2 hits in the walk. And the first hit didn't come into the 5th inning. And already tonight, Ron, 5 hits given up, 2 runs.
Well, you're on the road, you're in a strange place, and look, again, you look at the numbers in the last 4 or 5 games from Tulane offensively, there's been an awakening. And that's what I'm seeing. I saw it the other night against Nichols. Nichols didn't have anybody on the mound like Tim Cate,
right.
But these guys have carried through with their approach at home plate.
Jarrett DeHart now at the plate for the Greenwave, first pitch swing as well. Again, kind of starting to see an approach here for the Greenwave, trying to go and try to get that first pitch from Cate.
Well, he's going to challenge you and try to get ahead of you. They look to me like they're ready to go. That was a great pitch, though. That was fastball on your hands, really crowding DeHart.
Huskies took the lead in the top of the second. Tulane plating 2 here in the bottom of the third, still with the runner on first, and only 1 out. Pitch in there for a strike by Cate.
Yeah, he busts you inside, and then he goes hard away on the outer edge. That's some quality stuff right there.
After giving up a 2 RBI single, comes right back and gets ahead. The next batter, Jarrett DeHart here, ahead 0-2. Here's the pitch, swung on. And missed, runner on first, so he does not have to throw to first. Going.
Yeah, that's just a really good curveball.
It's a heck of a way to battle back, too, from Cate. Kind of shows you a little something there. Had a little brief visit on the mound. Comes right back, Ron, in 3 pitches. Picks up the second out.
That's the good one. It looks a little bad when you swing at one in that far in the dirt, or on the turf, I guess I should say, but when you chase one that far out of the zone, but you know what? That was his good yakker right over the top.
That'll bring up Hunter Hope, the third baseman. Popped up over to first base. And his first at bat back in the second inning. Hunter Williams over at first. First pitch to him. A ball.
Laid off it. That's the thing, you know. You try to explain to a hitter what it means is you are up there and you want to get your hands in the right position and you're going to swing until your eyes say no. It's got to be visual.
Williams with a bit of a lead over there at first. Cate takes a look at him before delivering to the plate. And it's low for a ball, 2-1-0.
Good look there at what I thought was an excellent curveball that you could have called a strike. That thing had a lot of break on it. Hunter doing a good job of taking it. Now he's ahead in the count. Let's see if you pick on your pitch.
Next pitch is in there. You can hear the mitt pop all the way up here.
Yeah, I was thinking, look, you got him behind in the count. He challenges you with a fastball upstairs. And Hunter, I'm not sure what he was looking at, but that one
had a little movement, started towards the center, and it wound up on the inside part of the plate there. 2 balls, 1 strike. 2 out here in the bottom of third. Tulane has played it 2. Lead it 2-1. UConn's run came in the top of the second inning. Time is called, and we'll reset things here.
Yeah, if you were looking fastball, that's one you probably should have hacked at. But you take pitches for a lot of reasons as a hitter. Sometimes you're not ready to swing.
2-1 pitch, slow and inside for a ball, so 3-1.
So he's still in a position where, you know what, you got to look fastball here. Now, you may not get it, but you got to look it.
Hunter Hope, 232 on the season coming into the game. Here's the 3-1 pitch. It's low and inside for a ball, and he will make his way over to first base.
That'll get Hosey up there, who had a pretty good hack at it his last time up.
Cody Hosey, the shortstop for the Green Wave, is now runners are on first and second. Two runs in already. Crate's pitch count approaching the 40 mark here at 38.
Hosey's impressed me, though. He looks like a young guy who's got an idea at the plate.
First pitch to him is in there for a strike.
Pretty good snake. We got a lot of names for curveballs, and this kid throws a good one. Snake, Yacker, Yellowhammer.
Benders.
Bender. Uncle Charlie.
Here's the 0-1.
That might be from a different era.
Yeah,
some of mine might be from a different era, right, though, Gus. But they still convey the message. It's not something you like. Nobody ever fell in love with a good curveball except somebody that threw it.
So a pair of hunters on the base pass for Tulane. Hunter Williams, Hunter Hope. And at the plate, Cody Hosey. One ball, one strike. Tim Kate trying to work out of a jam here. Curveball high and inside.
I tell you something, when you're not afraid to throw that curveball, even in the count.
And a quick meeting, Zach Susie.
Other than
to have a chat with Kate.
Other than one curveball that we chased, I feel like the Green Wave have done a good job of laying off his bad breaking balls. They've taken a couple over the plate that are called strikes. But at least you're making him throw strikes. And that's one of the things you're trying to do as a hitter.
Two balls and one strike after a brief meeting between Susie and Kate. Next pitch is low and inside, having trouble locating. It's, you know, odd you have that meeting on the mound with the coaching staff. And he came back and got the second out with three straight pitches. And since then, he's kind of struggled to find the plate here. Big pitch. Three balls, one strike. It's Cody Hosey trying to add another run for the Green Wave. And Tim Cates trying to get the Huskies back in the dugout and into the top of the fourth. The pitch is swung on and fouled straight back.
That was a violent hack by Hosey there, who clearly was locked on to number one. He had a pretty good swing at it. Almost overswung. Watch him here. He really lets it go. Hello. Look at this.
Oh, he woke up the gentleman in the blue long sleeve over there. Behind the plate? He had his eyes focused on something else.
Well, now you'll have the runners going with two outs, 3-2. See what happens.
Kate delivers. Curveball.
Okay. Hit it foul.
On and fouled over to the Green Wave dugout there.
3-2 curveball. That tells you
out
something,
ahead,
too.
For sure, he was looking fastball.
He's not afraid. No, he's not giving in a situation where the hitter can hurt you. That tells you something about the makeup of the left-hander out there.
Yeah,
he's
you can read
to
body
throw.
Language a lot of times in games. He doesn't look like he's panicking out there or anything at all.
I think, you know, when you've struck out as many guys as he has, yeah. I'm telling you, most of that's curveballs, and that's because he's got a lot of confidence in his ability to throw it.
Kate versus Hosey, and he walks him. Second straight walk for Tim Kate. And the Tulane Green Wave have the bases loaded here in the top of the third, or the bottom of the third inning, with two outs. Well, that'll bring up Grant Brown in center field, and Ron will go back to that play that kept it 1-0. You had a Husky on his way home, and just before he crosses home plate, Brown throws back.
Yeah, that's a real bad
runner that was crossing second base and tagged him out to end the inning there. That was out number three.
You could call that a really bad base running play, but a really heads-up throw. And the right guy up there now, Brown swinging the bat pretty good. Had a knock his first time up. Got a chance here to do some real damage with two outs and the bags juiced.
He has 11 RBIs, batting 235 coming into the contest. First pitch from Kate. Is high and inside for a ball. You know, for Tulane's Sam Yonyeld, you got to like the rest that you had here. He'd been in trouble, really, first, second, and third innings, at least giving up base runners in each of those innings. Getting a little extended rest here as Tulane looking to tack on more. Up 2-1, both runs coming in this inning. Next pitch is fouled. We'll do it again. UConn getting that one run in the second inning.
Brown, 5 hits in his last 5 games, so he's making some contact. Got a knock in this one, and hitting in a situation here where you would like to believe he'll get something decent to hit at.
So we've seen Kate Ron go inside a lot. See if he changes things up here. Here's the 1-1. Curveball, and Brown held off on that.
That is a good look right there because, as we mentioned, he's comfortable throwing that curveball, and it's a good one whenever he wants. Look at this.
I tell you what, it moved.
It's got some, you know what? What the new term is spin rate. He's got some spin rate on that one.
Doyle Scooter at first base. The plate umpire Doug Williams pointed at and said he did not go around. So 2 balls, 1 strike. Kate delivers. Fastball is low. So that's 2 straight walks. Hunter Holt walked. Cody Hosey walked. Grant Brown now ahead 3-1 with the bases loaded. As catcher Zach Soucy goes up, has a little conversation here. Joining him also on the mound is the shortstop Anthony Prado.
Well, it just appeared to me you're hitting against a pretty darn good left-handed pitcher who really wants to show you that fastball and get you out with curveballs. But they've done a good job of not chasing bad ones. It's hard not to when you've got when it has as much bite as this guy's curveball.
The old Ducks on a pond here. Bases loaded for Tulane. 2 runs in already in the bottom half of the third, looking to tack on more. The 3-1 from Kate. In for a strike.
Wow.
Grant Brown
couldn't believe
was making his way to first base. The home folks don't care for it.
Wow.
And for Tim Kate, located it right at the knees, Ron.
Wow. Maybe just there. Maybe just there. Look, you can't say, oh, no, that's impossible. No. He's throwing down on you. Could have gotten the front edge of that strike zone.
3 balls, 2 strikes. Brown, Kate, here we go. Ground ball to third off the chest of Yon, and no play will be made. And Brown.
Take that.
Will get.
I'd call that a base hit.
The first base. Let's see what the official score will be.
I know this. You can call it anything you want, but it was a nasty ground ball that the third baseman, Yon, had to work hard to get in front of. And that's a 3-2 curveball that Brown hit hard, came on a in-between hop, and just ate up the third baseman.
Hunter Williams will score. Hope goes to third. Goes over the second, and Brown makes his way over to first.
That to me is a great at-bat.
Giving in an error.
Yeah.
Jake Wilsey now at the plate, and a ball to him.
I'll tell you what, that was a great at-bat by Grant Brown.
No activity in the Huskies' bullpen as of yet. Again, just in the bottom of the third inning, and perhaps a lot of that thinking from head coach Jim Penders, too, is Bjorneld hadn't exactly had a 1-2-3 inning himself either.
No, this is your ace.
Kate down in a hole, 2-0 inside. He's missing inside and higher, inside and low.
His fastball's been down out of the zone a bunch, and I just wonder, too, this is all AstroTurf. This kid's probably never pitched off a mound like this before. Now, you can get used to it, but the first time you see it, it might feel strange to you.
Third run has played it for the Green Wave. 2 balls, no strikes. We'll see at the plate. Here's the delivery. And it's in there for a strike on the outside.
9th hitter of the inning for Tulane. With the bag still loaded. I can't, again, tell you how good an at-bat I thought that was by Grant Brown.
Talking about that mound, Ron Sobota, you saw there. It is different. There is no dirt to kind of kick and kind of get a feel with your heels.
The good news is nobody comes out there and digs a hole where you don't want it.
All right, Wilsey puts a stick on it. Problem is it's on its way to the hack shack.
Yanked it hard.
Fouled off. You know, you mentioned that again. By no means compare me with Cy Young, but the Little League pitching days, Ron. That's one of the things you do. You're right. Some people, that's the first thing you see a lot of pitchers at any level, right? They'll get out there with their heels and they'll dig their hole right into a certain spot of the mound. You kind of can't do that. And it's sort of like
Neil Young, maybe, right? But not Cy.
Well, exactly. And you remember, a lot of batters do that at a hitting box, yes, as well, to try to, you know, make it to where they're comfortable in. And you wonder if you're not used to something like that, that release point, that push-off foot, if you can sort of do that. Two balls, two strikes to Woolsey. Let's see what Kate does here. And the fastball is low and inside. And look, he's been consistent all night. Doug Williams hasn't called outside or inside corners on either pitcher tonight. That was close there, Ron.
Williams' strike zone has been good and consistent. I can't really argue with that. You might have quibbled on that one pitch, but I'm going to tell you something. This guy is working consistently down, and I have to, you know, we got TV to look at. I think Williams has done a good job back there.
Three balls, two strikes, runners go, and it's popped up in on the infield. The shortstop's looking for it. Prado backing up,
trouble.
And it's going to miss it. One run in, two runs in, three runs come in on a huge error by Anthony Prado, who, Ron, you saw him immediately look straight up, and he lost the ball. He lost it immediately, and you can see him saying it. Look at the replay here. Right when the ball comes off of Wilsey's bat, you see him immediately.
He's lost.
He has no idea where the ball is.
That's the universal signal for help.
Yon trying to help out.
That's a base hit, by the way.
It is. It fell.
Three RBIs. Nobody touched it. Sorry. He's looking up like there's going to be more. Oh, that's what a helpless, futile feeling. That's the third out, and they put three runs up as a result.
Got a feel for the kid, because if you've ever been in that situation, you can't find the ball. It's not a good feeling there. Next pitch comes to Paul Gazzo, and it's swung on. And Tim Cate, seeing six runs, plated this inning, remember, a week ago, 7 1/3, 13 strikeouts, two hits, one walk. That first hit off of him did not come until the fifth inning. And Tulane, six runs and already six hits on him through three. Second pitch, ground ball in the hole, and it's going to get through. Another run's going to come in as Prado outstretched, got on his glove, but got through and was unable to keep it in. Paul Grazzo with an RBI. His second hit of the inning.
For Gazzo. Wow. Well, you know, UConn played a midweek game.
Jake Woolsey comes in and scores. He was on his way going with two outs here as well. Tim Cate facing the top of the order for the Green Wave yet again in this inning. And it's right fielder Grant Witherspoon reached on a fielder's choice. That pitch count's gone up to 58 now. Kate.
I started to mention that they played a midweek game and had an eight-run inning against Bryan State.
The spoon shows bunt, pulls back. The ball is in there for a strike. And you can see the deep exhale there by the shortstop, Anthony Prado. You know, we're still thinking about that, Ron. He catches that pop-up. They're out the inning. Instead, it's 7-1 here, bottom of the third. Wave still batting. Pitches low and inside for Cate.
Well, the shortstop, Prado, has made 10 errors. That will not go in the book as an error, but it is the worst thing that's happened to him.
It's not where the sun is. The sun is setting into deep left field if you're looking at it.
I think that ball just got out of the lights real fast.
From the screen, the sun is behind you to the right. Nice curveball there as Witherspoon cannot hold up for strike number two. So if he lost it, it will be in the lights or in the backdrop, as we do have activity in the UConn bullpen.
Well, you know, the other thing, it goes up above the lights. Now that darkens it up a little bit, and then there's the wind blowing out, and it carries a little more.
The 1-2, and taking second base is Paul Gazzo. Pitch was low and away, and catcher Zuzi had trouble getting it. So for Gazzo, his first stolen base of the season, Ron.
And, you know, Zuzi as a catcher, I'm told, is still working on the mechanics of that position.
This One's popped up to center field, making an effort and getting there is Keith Krueger. Had to get on his horse to go pick it up over into the Tulane Green Wave logo there. So in the inning, seven runs come in. Tulane leads at 7-1 at the end of three on the American Digital Network.
We are America. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
7-1 going into the top of the fourth inning. Seven hits, no errors for the UConn Huskies. A run, four hits, and an error as they get back on the offensive side of things. Gus Kattengill and Ron Sroboda with you. Ron, when you look at Tulane's pitcher, Sam Bjornjeld, he hasn't exactly had a 1-2-3 inning, so UConn looking to get back on the offensive side of things here.
Yeah, look, if you're UConn, You've already taken your measure of Tulane pitching, and you said, hey, let's not give up the ghost here. We could get back in this thing if we just make some stuff happen, because this pitching staff is capable of giving up a few. They've looked at all the box scores.
John Topal falling off the first pitch. Second pitch high for a ball. 1-for-1 on the day. Singled over the left field his last at bat in the second inning. A fielder for the Huskies. Fouls off pitch number three. Behind him and to the right.
Sophomore. Big good looking kid. Yeah, I mean, that's an inning that really shouldn't have happened to you, but it did.
And right back, they get a single. So, sort of the way the game has been on the offensive end for UConn. They've had a runner on in every single base, and they have a leadoff hit by John Topal, his second hit of the ball game. So a two-hit game far for him.
Yeah, you got to just keep hacking, and you know, you're not going to hit a seven-run home run and tie it up. You're going to have to put it together piece by piece, and that means one good at-bat after another.
Again, you could have had almost two runs in that second inning. As the first pitch over to Chris Winkle is fouled off, giving chase is Gazzo, and it goes foul. But they had a runner on in the first inning, didn't get him in. In the second, they got one across the plate, and that's when the throwback over at second happened. You could have had two runs in the second inning. Had a runner on via a walk in the third inning, and here a leadoff hit in the fourth for John Topal. Chris Winkle now at the plate. First baseman for the Huskies.
I wonder how it is for Bjornjeld, who, you know, had to sit there and get cold.
Is it a positive or is it a negative, having sat there for a while?
How many times when you have to sit there that long and then the other team comes to bat and you're having to loosen up and you're not loose.
It's outside for a ball. I guess you can look at it either way. Because he had been, I guess, in some trouble in that second.
A lot of times, I've seen it in college baseball, when they see a big inning like that developing, the guy will go down there in the pen and throw a few.
Wrinkle 229 on the season, swings and a miss for out number one.
Good breaking ball.
First strikeout of the ball game for Bjornjeld. That'll bring up the second baseman, Jack Limp. Brett. Yeah.
Maybe I'm overemphasizing how stiff you can get, because at the age of 72, I'm already too stiff to get up and do anything. It's only the third inning. But I don't mind. This, look, I firmly believe this game ain't necessarily over. Okay?
Now, Bjorniel gets the first pitch in there for a strike. Here's the 0-1. Swing and a miss by Lambrick.
Good fastball, outer edge. Good four-seamer.
No balls, two strikes. To the Huskies' second baseman, here's the delivery. Curveball in the outside corner is there for a ball. Again, you look back at that third inning. The bases loaded, a pop-up. The shortstop, Anthony Prado, lost it in the lights. Three runs come in to score on that. And in an inning before that, again, the play by Grant Brown, keeping it 1-0, not 2-0. And Lambrick singles over the left as Lex Kaplan unable to get there in time. So two hits in the inning. And again, kind of going back to what we said, Ron, it's not like you haven't faced Bjorniel in, haven't gotten any swings on or had Huskies on the base.
You see him jumping up and down because he, on the mound, he made a pretty good pitch. And Lambrick doing a great job to go down there and get it. And didn't hit it real hard, but he didn't have to. Just drop it in there, get guys on base, make something happen. Just, you got a lot of baseball to play here.
One out in the inning. Keith Krueger, center fielder on deck, at the plate, rather, for the Huskies. First pitch to him in there for a strike. Now, you mentioned you can't get a seven-run home run, but you can get one here, one there, two here, two there, with plenty of baseball left to be played. And, again, against a pitcher that you've managed to be able to get runners on base with.
Look, I don't think that UConn, I don't think the Huskies have any reason to feel like this is a pitching staff that they can't get something done against. Things went a little squirrely, and they gave up a whole lot more runs than really should have happened to them, but you're a long way from out of it.
Down the bottom of the third inning, we saw activity in the bullpen as the pitch is swung on to the shortstop, and a backhand play by Hosey is going to be held.
Yeah. Interesting play by Tapa at second base. He went back to second with runners at first and second. It's a fielder's choice 6-3 force play, a 6-5 force play for the out.
So making the comment that you don't see the activity in there as well, so either he has got the delivery or not. As
no, I don't. I
Hosey goes to Hunter Hope. As you said, no one advanced for UConn there.
No. This kid's ready to pitch some innings for you, Tim Cate. And
here's Prado. First pitch swinging over to right. And just some to the right of the foul line down
that wasn't
right side
a long
of the
way
field
out
here.
That was not far from being a little bit of trouble and that little bit of something we
probably
talked
at least
about
a run, if not two, for sure. Difference of about a foot or two.
Baseball's a game of inches, they say. Now it's a game of spin rate, launch angle, all these new terms coming into baseball.
Don't forget about analytics.
Oh, that is part and parcel of it.
He's the 0-1, swung on
what,
and fouled back.
I was interviewing one of the Baby Cakes, our local AAA team. I was interviewing an outfielder for them, asking him, he had hit a few home runs more last year than the year before. I said, have you done anything with your launch angle change? He looked at me and said, I don't know anything about launch angle. I'm just trying to hit the thing. And I said, boy, am I glad you said that. Because I don't know much about some of this new business.
Prado in a hold, 0-2. You know he wants to redeem after missing that pop-up. And he'll ground out to his fellow shortstop, Cody Hosey. And the Huskies fail to get a run in. Two hits in the inning. No runs. No errors. And runner left on base. 7-1 going into the bottom of the fourth on the American Digital Network.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard. This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Welcome back to New Orleans, Tulane and UConn here in the bottom of the fourth inning. Green Wave lead at 7-1. Ron Sroboda, Gus Cattingill with you. And Ron, as you see the Tulane bench there, things didn't start out very well for first-year head coach Travis Jewett, replacing Coach Pierce, who went on over to Texas. Tulane, a regional appearance in the postseason last year, as UConn was as well. They lose their head coach. Travis Jewett comes in from Vanderbilt. Things did not start out well, but they've won 12 of their last 18. And as you know all too well in baseball, you just win series and eventually you kind of see where it goes.
Yeah, the ebb and flow. And they've had some serious ebb and flow if you consider that 2-12 run they were on as Lex Kaplan swings at a pretty nasty-looking fastball.
Two doubles in the game, by the way. A double in the first and a double in the third.
Against a tough left-hander.
And Kate still back out there. Again, it was activity in the bullpen last half inning. Or last inning, rather.
Lex is a guy, too. I mean, he was the first of those seniors to kind of ignite. Struggled early, just seemed like he was an out looking for a place to happen. And then all of a sudden, he dialed it in and has been a big part of this recent success by the Green Wave.
Next pitch is fouled on. One ball, two strikes. So the Green Wave turning things around, still below 500, though. 15-18 on the season. But as you mentioned earlier, five games, the last five, they've batted 350, 37 runs, 62 hits, 35 RBIs, and 8 homers. So a test here against the solid UConn pitching as Kate bounces back here and leads off the bottom of the fourth with a strikeout of Lex Kaplan.
Yeah, that's a great curveball that Kate threw him. It looked like Kaplan saw it, has a pretty good swing at it, but look, that's pretty good.
It might be
a fastball. Might be more of a fastball. He kind of
I'll bring up Hunter Williams, one for two
there
today. And Ron, when you take a look at it, you know, teams like to measure themselves, don't they? Like to see how good they are. And again, when you take a look at it, UConn, fifth in the nation, averaging 10 strikeouts a game, 272 in 26 games. I'm going to assume that that's a lot there as Kate gets out ahead of Hunter Williams 0-1.
And you know, this series is just opening up. I mean, this game is not over, and this series has just begun. And, you know, UConn is edging up towards, you know, towards ranking. And everything is what you do in the next couple of weeks in college baseball to see how this American Athletic Conference goes.
Kate delivers, and it's fouled on straight back.
Was it 2013 or so? Or when this conference started. UConn, as you mentioned, won it last year.
It was their second championship in the last four seasons as Williams lifts one to the right, Wynn taking it, and right before the warning track, Isaac Feldstein tracks it down for the second out of the inning. The importance not only for Kate, but also for the rest of the series and also for the UConn team, if you can get a 1-2-3 inning here to bounce back and show, because we talked about the body language last inning, and for him to come out here, get the strikeout of Kaplan, get the out of Hunter Williams, and if he can get out with this next batter and make it a 1-2-3 inning, kind of shows you the poise, perhaps, that he has as well.
Well, you know what? They look down the line, and they got Will Montgomery, a right-hander who's a junior, who's another real big arm that strikes out a whole lot of guys that has had good success this year. You know, they don't have to concede anything at any point.
Jarrett DeHart now at the plate for the Green Wave. Ball one strike to him.
Here's what you find out about somebody, too. Tim Cate, things clearly not going. He hasn't had an inning like this year.
Ron, second baseman Jack Lambrecht, a little deep there.
Still coming out and competing like it's a nothing-nothing game.
Looking for DeHart probably to pull as the pitch is fouled on outside.
You don't see anything in Cate's body language to indicate he just had the worst inning of his college career. That's what I like.
You don't see a pop up the short, get lost in the lights with the bases loaded and three-run score very often. Cate looks to get out this inning with a strikeout, but just a little outside.
Well, you know, he was in a little bit of trouble before that happened, had given up a couple, but that was the icing on the cake for just a debacle of an inning. But the guy's still out there giving you what he has.
Here's the 1-2 again low. When he got in trouble in that inning, he was missing low. He was missing inside to right-handed batters or outside. As we mentioned, and, you know, if you're a Huskies fan watching, you going, man, he can't get anything low. He can't get anything on the outside. Look, home plate umpire Doug Williams has been calling like that the entire game. Here's a 3-2 pitch. Fastball, you heard the mitt pop, and he gets two strikeouts in the inning. So nice bounce back inning by Tim Cate. Fourth inning in the books, and at the end of four, Tulane 7, UConn 1 on the American Digital Network.
We are America, the conference of opportunity, the opportunity to chase dreams, the opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Clearfield Turchin Stadium in New Orleans, an absolutely gorgeous Thursday evening. Temps just below 80, around 78, 79 at first pitch. The sun has set. Winds blowing out of the north there, Ron. At least right to left here. Not very humid. See the flags in center field.
This is Chamber of Commerce weather for New Orleans, as you well know.
No doubt.
There is something called July and August waiting for you right down the road.
Top of the fifth inning led off here by Willie Yawn. Fielder's choice in the first inning, grounded out to third in the third inning. UConn trailing 7-1. Approaching the 70-pitch mark is Bjorn Yeld. Left-hander for the Green Wave. Second pitch is inside and low. You mentioned at the beginning of the broadcast that in speaking with the Tulane staff, somewhere in the mid-70s, I'm going to start keeping an eye on him here. Does a six-run lead change your pitch count? Or do you still have that sort of number based off of where you think he can go and his strengths? As
you know, if
the count is now 1-2.
I think you're right. If he's struggling out there, which he is not, you might start thinking that 75 is too much. But if he's cruising and you feel like he doesn't have great big innings, you'll ask him, how you doing? Well, he said, how you feel?
UConn's had a runner in every inning. They had two hits last inning, just couldn't get anybody over. He did have a strikeout, Bjorn Yell. Here's the 1-2, high curveball. He hasn't had that since the beginning of the game, Ron. Hasn't really had that break.
Right.
The count is now 2-2. Pitch 74 coming in, he hit him.
Pointing.
Willie Yawn. Moving that elbow, the home crowd.
A little shoulder
thinking
action.
Thinking that he did that, and you know what? Home plate umpire Doug Williams agrees. He's calling back Willie Yawn, saying that he moved into that pitch.
You can let it hit you, but he just kind of leaned into it, took it for the team. Watch it. It's a curveball. Oh, There he goes. Leave that out there. Oh, sorry. Nice try. Good thought.
Well, the count's still 3-2, and he takes it to right field for a base hit. So one way or the other, he's going to make his way over to first to throw back over there. From right fielder Grant Weatherspoon to Hunter Williams, not in time. As Willie Yawn will get a base hit.
That was a guy that was going to get on base.
One way or another, Willie Yawn was getting to first base, and he did. Taking what the pitcher gives you and
that's a great
putting it
piece
over
of
to right field.
Terrific piece of hitting on a fastball.
All right, so Zach Soucy, you talked about him as one of the key players at the beginning of the broadcast. He's the catcher. Ground out the third, and he's walked so far this game.
Yeah, I think that walk.
First pitch swinging popped up straight up. Calling it is Hunter Williams, and he makes the play. So a big out there for the Green Wave and for Zach Soucy. Still looking for his first hit of the ball game.
Boy, was that skied.
For some reason, the bugs have decided to come out now. Is it termite season yet in New Orleans?
isn't it always? But I don't know if that's what has the wings. Usually when you see a lot of bugs around the lights, it is termites. But a
couple of ground outs so far for Isaac Feldstein, the right fielder. Shortstop in third so far in the game. The throw over to first by Bjarnyeld.
He's had a couple of curveballs he's hit to the shortstop with alarming regularity. He had pretty good swings at him, but he hit the top of the ball and hit little rollers to the shortstop.
Big swing in the miss there by Feldstein.
Fastball.
255 on the season coming into the series. 19 RBIs. 28 hits, 10 doubles, no triples in two homers. Yoniel delivers, and it's hit back over to right and into the stands. As you see in the camera shot, the
like he was trying
little
to get
winged
it all
friends
yeah.
making themselves at home here.
They are there.
In the early dusk. As we just hit 8 o'clock Central Time. In the first of three games. No balls, two strikes. Here's the pitch well outside for a ball. Tomorrow night's game, same starting time, 7:30 Eastern, 6:30 Central. And then on Saturday, an 11 a.m. Central first pitch, noon over on the East Coast. In stores.
Heading into the Easter weekend is the reason we're playing tonight. Right. Opening up Sunday for that important holiday.
1-2 high and outside. Two balls, two strikes. Runner on first, and that is Willie Yawn. There's the 2-2 curveball. Just hasn't been there all day. As it stays high. So three balls, two strikes. Again, going back to where we're talking about the big inning for UConn. Little confidence you can get some runs on as Bjarnyeld hasn't had the command and you've had runners on in every inning, including this one here in the fifth.
He's made some good pitches.
Here's
the
pitch. Well, speaking of, a swing and a miss.
And that's an elevated fastball to strike him out.
Little juice there, and it's the second strikeout in as many innings here.
Top end of the zone. And you know, it was an interesting piece in the New York Times a couple of weeks ago talking about you don't have to throw that four-seamer up in the zone. If you get good spin rate on it and it carries better, you can throw it upper 80s, low 90s.
Tyler Nesda sees a strike to open up his at-bat.
The difference is getting that good spin rate so it carries. The hitter, it looks big as a beach ball. But
Nesda.
Hard to get to.
A hit in the second and ground out in the third over to short. Second pitch is fouled back, so in the hole 0-2. No activity in the Green Wave bullpen, and the reason I mention that, Ron, is pitch 85 coming up for Bjarnyeld.
Yep. Well, they're comfortable, and so is he.
Next pitch is grounded over to third. Hope picks it up, fires across the diamond, and in time. So the Huskies yet again get a runner on the leadoff walk. but failed to get a run. Bottom of the fifth coming up. Wave lead at 7-1 on the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
As you can see, roll wave, and the green wave had one inning in which things were rolling in their direction. Ron Sirbota, Gus Cattingill with you. That was the third inning. The lone error you see on the scoreboard for the UConn Huskies, a run, six hits, and an error came on a pop-up to shortstop Anthony Prado. Lost it in the lights. I guess you could say maybe the termites is what he lost it in, Ron. But three runs came in. The bases were loaded. That kind of helped open up the inning there. Tim Cate back out on the mound for the UConn Huskies, as seven runs came in the third inning on four hits. Nothing doing in the fourth, and here in the bottom of the fifth inning, Hunter Hope will lead things off 0 for 1 on the day. First pitch from Cate. Is swung on and hit deep in the left field. And Ron, that has gone deep into the night. A home run.
That's a rocket.
By Hunter Hope. First pitch swinging, something we've seen a lot of Tulane batters do today, and he was on it immediately, and that was a no-brainer.
Yeah, we're in New Orleans. That one landed in Jefferson Parish. Wow.
You don't see the balls here at Griffield Turchin Stadium go above the scoreboard very often. Ron, that was above the scoreboard immediately.
Wow.
As there was no doubt about that one. A 1-2-3 inning by Tim Cate. Last inning.
That's home run number seven for Hope, who, as we mentioned, this guy was lost at home plate and has now he is found over the last half a dozen games. Unbelievable.
Cody Hosey now steps up to the plate for the Green Wave. Shortstop, a walk and a fly out to center. Two at bats today. First pitch from Cate is in there for a strike. And now some activity over in the Huskies' bullpen.
That was just left up out over the plate, and he squared it up big time. That thing jumped out of here.
You see the replay there. You know that ball was hit high when you didn't even see it in the replay. Pop up. Making chase is Chris Winkle. And it's just over the
screen
netting there.
That was coming back on the field.
Covers the UConn bench.
Yeah, that screening that protects the fans and whatnot along the first baseline. Because these stands are very close to the action, and you need something there.
For Hunter Hope, that was the third look at a pitcher. Is that something that out of the dugout as a hitter you sort of have in your mind? Hey, I'm first fastball I see, I'm on it.
He just left that one right over Broadway, and he was, I guess, going up there looking for it, put a good swing on it.
As he fouls back the second pitch down in the count 0-2. I want to say, Ron, honestly, that was probably the hardest hit ball against Cate today. I mean, I say that obviously it was a home run, but.
Oh, no, that ball was flat.
I'm saying
squared
the
up,
entire
yeah.
game, though, that was really probably the best hit off of Cate today.
I can't argue with that. That thing went, that had a couple of different stages to it.
0-2 bounced over to third base. Willian has it across the diamond in time for out number one. Posey is retired. That'll bring up Grant Brown. Single in the second. RBI in the third.
He had that ground ball. He hit to third base is the error. He had a hard two-hopper.
Right.
Jan got it on an in-between hop and knocked it down with the bases loaded. That was ruled an error.
Brown batting 245 on the season. First pitch to him. a ball. I'll get you a number here in a second.
So he's had a couple of good swings tonight.
I want to say that's Trevor Holmes over in the Huskies bullpen. It's curveball in there for a strike. One ball, one strike. One out here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Wave lead it 8-1. Then seven runs coming in on the third. UConn got their lone run in the second. Another run should have come, but Grant Brown, center fielder for the Wave, threw back at second. The Huskies runner was going on his way to third, kind of overran second.
Yes,
they threw
he did.
Behind him.
Cost, and in going back to second, he made the out quicker, and the run did not score.
Down in a count here, one ball, two strikes. Low and inside, a fastball over by his feet. Tim Cade a week ago gave up just two hits, and that first hit didn't come all the way into the fifth inning. Also had 13 strikeouts. Have him just as one right now. Well, make that two. Beautiful curveball there.
Wow.
Make that.
Look,
I can't
that
read
starts.
My own handwriting. Look, four strikeouts now.
Yeah. He had two last inning.
Right.
Would have made, that's strikeout number five.
A pretty curve for sure.
Oh, that's a nasty.
Jake Woolsey comes up.
Woolsey, the beneficiary of that pop-up with two outs in the bag's juice that fell.
A pop-up that will be talked about for the Greenway fans for sure.
Just tough luck, you know. You're a shortstop in a new stadium.
But he lost it in the lights immediately.
Lost it probably out of the lights. It went above the lights quickly and out of his vision.
First pitch to Wilsey is a strike. Second pitch down low. And you think about it for Cade as the pitcher. You make the pitch you want. You get everything you want. He's popping up to shortstop. You're out of the inning. And instead.
But no. Yeah. Well, you know. Things happen in baseball.
1-1 swung on and missed by Wilsey.
If I was scouting Tim Cade tonight, though, I would just be saying, look how much better some of his breaking balls are at this point.
That's a move.
That wasn't a breaking ball. That was a fastball that hope.
Well, and that, to your point, you have the breaking balls being swung on and missed, and that fastball hit over the fence. Breaking ball there. Chopped over to third. Solid play by Willie Yawn to get out of the inning there. And UConn gets on out of the inning. And we have played five in New Orleans. Hunter Oak hitting a homer over the left field. Adds a run for the Wave. 8-1 of the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
It's game one of a three-game series here between UConn coming in leading the American Conference in Tulane in a three-way tie with USF Houston. Four wins, two losses in conference play. UCF, Memphis, Cincinnati, two wins, four losses in East Carolina, 0-6. One of the teams that UConn defeated early on to get to that 6-0 conference start. Gus Kattengill, Ron Sroboda with you here in New Orleans, Grierfield Turchin Stadium. Absolutely gorgeous evening. And so far, a good one for the Green Wave. They lead 8-1, leading off here. The top of the sixth inning is Troy Stefanski. And
he hitting for Tapa.
He is pinch hitting for left fielder John Topa. He has two balls and No strikes in his advantage. Next pitch by Bjornfeld is high for 3-0. And now there is activity in the Tulane bullpen. And again, to our point that we've been making, Bjornfeld hasn't exactly had 1-2-3 innings. I mean, the Huskies have had a runner on every single inning. They just have only been able to get a runner on once.
He's done a good job, though, of pitching out of that trouble and getting ground balls when he needed them.
Three balls and two strikes.
He only has two strikeouts, in this ball game. So he's done a good job of throwing ground balls.
Chase Selesky warming up in the Tulane bullpen. Here's the 3-2 fouled, and that is on its way over the Ullman Stadium, the football stadium. Oh, the Tulane Green Wave over to the left.
Yep, freshman, right-hander.
Next pitch is singled and lined right up the middle for a base hit. So once again, run. The Huskies have a leadoff runner. They did it in the fifth. Here, Troy Stefanski. Nice piece of hitting there. The ball is low and away. It's actually a nice pitch, but he just kind of dropped the barrel of the bat there.
Pretty good effort. Had a pitch to hit, though.
So the top of the sixth inning. A leadoff hit, Chris Winkle, first baseman. For the Huskies, sees a first pitch strike.
Interesting you send a left-hander up to hit against the left-hander, so you must be comfortable with how he handles left-handed pitching.
Winkle, ground ball over the short. It's going to be a backhand tough play, not in time. Oh, wow.
Ooh, wow.
I thought he was safe there at second. Cody Hosey backhanded it.
Yeah, that was deep in the hole. I thought he might have at least tied it. We'll get a good look at it here on the replay, though. Rolled it into the hole.
The slide started before the ball's coming in. Ooh, I tell you what.
Gee whiz.
I think he was safe there at second.
That's a break. He could have easily called him.
Next pitch is lined up. Jim Lampert. Over to third. Hunter Hope fires to Williams, but in time and back is Winkle. Lambrecht, rather, lines out.
That was hard.
Ron, he was on this one. Kind of a reaction there by Hope. Trying to turn around and try to double back.
Good base running play Winkle. By Stefanski.
Keith Krueger now up to the plate, center fielder. Had an RBI in the second and reach on the fielder's choice in the fourth. 1-for-2.
I should say Winkle, the runner at first base, reading that line drive, making sure you got a last thing the coach tells you is make those line drives go through. Can't go anywhere. If they're low enough to be caught, you've got to see them go through.
Pitch down the middle high for a ball, 1-0. Yarniel delivers, runner going, and it's fouled off to the left side. So back to first, Winkle will go. Going back to that play at second. Tell you, I thought Stefanski's foot maybe would have gotten in there just a little bit there. But, you know, here's the thing. The second base umpire is right there. He's staring right at it.
Yeah. No, it looked close.
Doyle Scooter is staring at it. He's got the view in it, so he's closer than we are in the booth as the curveball's in there for a strike. From our vantage point in the replay, it looks like the foot's going in before the ball gets in, but...
Well, we're watching.
I mean, he's literally on the fake dirt.
We saw it live. We saw it live. We saw it in replay. And both times we thought there was a chance he could have been safe.
Yes. Swing and a miss. Paul Gazzo will pick it up and fire to first to end the Husky sixth inning. 8-1, Tulane leads it. As we come back, the Green Wave. Come back looking to add to it as Bjornfeld has a quick inning. On the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
Each team with eight hits. Green Wave with eight runs, though. UConn with one. Again, the big inning for Tulane coming in the third. 7-4, Gus Cattingell, Ron Svoboda with you. It's game one of a three-game series between first-place UConn and the Tulane Green Wave, a three-way tie in the American Conference with USF and Houston, each team with four wins and two losses. As UConn has a new pitcher, Ron Svoboda.
Yeah, Trevor Holmes is a redshirt junior from Ashland, Massachusetts. Big kid, too. Looks like 6'1", 228.
I'll give you the final line here in a second on Tim Cate. As catcher Paul Gazzo. Couple of RBIs here. Batted twice in the third inning. That big seven-run third inning. Two for two on the evening. First pitch swinging, fouled straight back. It's Tim Cate a week ago. As you see, Holmes, 3-1, 240 ERA.
Not one of the guys that I was told would come into the game if this thing was close.
Gazzo gets on one but pulls it foul over the Tulane bullpen here and left. Final numbers on Cate. Five innings pitched, eight runs, three of them were earned, eight hits, two walks, five strikeouts. 94 total pitches. Ron Svoboda.
Pretty good work.
As Holmes delivers and Gazzo pops it up. First baseman Chris Winkle under it and secures it for out number one.
Tony, his fifth appearance, Holmes.
Grant Weatherspoon, top of the order for the Tulane Green Wave. The right fielder. Popped up to first in the first. Reached on a fielder's choice and scored in the third. Have him 0 for 3. Ground ball over the short. Prado secures a tough hop there. And in time, quickly two outs here in the bottom of the sixth.
Shortstop doing a good job. Prado getting to the ball. And, you know, if UConn plays on a natural dirt and grass field, but playing on this turf is really an easier transition than coming from turf to playing on regular grass.
Lex Kaplan 2 for 3 today, a double and a first, a double and a third, and struck out his last at bat, swinging a miss on pitch number one from Trevor Holmes. In on relief, Tim Cate.
Holmes right over the top with what looked like a breaking ball.
Another pitch is right up the middle. Tough play coming up and getting his Lambrecht, and he gets him in time. Solid play by the second baseman, charging the ball, barehanded it and throwing it over to first to retire the Tulane Green Wave. 1-2-3, go the Wave. As you can see, solid effort. That's Prado, rather, that did it.
Short stuff.
American Digital Network.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulanians are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
75 degrees on this Thursday evening in New Orleans as we welcome you back to Greer Field, Turchin Stadium. The Tulane Green Wave lead it 8-1. You see the Smoothie King Center and the Mercedes-Benz Superdome there, home of the Saints and Pelicans, both teams in the offseason.
City looking good on a clear night.
NBA playoffs coming up.
Actually,
starting this weekend.
I went to the All-Star game, which, of course, is a shoot 'em up, run and shoot. But it was fun to see those guys doing it.
New pitcher for the Tulane Green Wave as we welcome you back inside the stadium. That is number 29, Chase Selesky, the freshman right-hander, Ron.
Yeah, he's really been a great find for him when you're looking for pitching. You got a rookie, I should say. They call him a rookie here, that first-year guy, but he's a freshman from Fort Pierce, Florida.
And Anthony Prada, who made that final out there, sees the first pitch inside. Thought it was the second baseman. Apologies, Jack Lambrecht. And Prado came across the diamond and fielded it in front of him.
He really made a good play on that slow run. If he doesn't get it, Kaplan is safe.
And again, you have to feel for him. Again, he's involved in the pop-up that's going to be talked about.
Yep.
Seven runs in the third, bases loaded, pop-up, and he lost it almost immediately off the bat of Wilsey. And it landed behind him in shallow left or deep short, however you want to call it. But it landed on the floor, on the field, and three runs for the Green Wave came in. Two balls, one strike to him.
Yeah, absolute wrong time for that to happen.
Brown ball.
Oh, nice play.
Nice play by Hunter Hope.
Ooh,
spins and fires across the diamond in time for an out.
5-3, pretty slick there. Interesting story, Selesky, in that here's a freshman comes in here. You're looking at stuff that doesn't blow your eyes away. You know, it's not what you would call electric. He's got a mid-80s fastball that he can move around in and out, a curveball and a changeup he'll use. But he's got a certain presence out there. And you know what? You can't find that somewhere and implant it in someone. It has to be in there, I think. And
Willie Yon at the plate for UConn. Two balls, no strikes on him. Sam Bionniel, the starter for the Green Wave. Six innings, eight hits, one run. It was earned, two walks and three strikeouts. Six innings, eight hits, a run. It was earned, two walks and three Ks. And it was never really a quick inning for him. I mean, the quickest inning was the sixth there, in which he did give up a hit to lead off, but a fielder's choice, a strikeout, and also a line out the third got him out. But it was that night. At the end of the day, you didn't have to go deep into the pen, and you're up 8-1.
He made great pitches when he had to, I thought, for the most part, competing.
Ground ball, Hunter Hope's been busy today. Cross the diamond in time. Willie on 2-for-3. Now dropped to 2-for-4.
Well, there you go.
Back-to-back putouts by Hunter Hope.
You got a hitter who's ahead of you. He gets that fastball, kind of sinks it a little bit, and, you know, he's adding and subtracting to things. Hitter rolls it over to third base, and Hunter Hope has been vacuuming that stuff up today.
Zach Susie, Huskies catcher, trying to get going here. Grounded out to third, had a walk, and flying out, popped up to the first baseman.
Hunter's been like that machine they use on the field, you know, to brush it out. No, he just gets everything.
Oh. Ground ball right back at Selesky.
Wow.
Makes the play himself in a 1-2-3 inning for the Tulane Green Wave. We'll come to bat here in the bottom of the seventh. They lead it 8-1 in game one of a three-game series against UConn. Huskies in first place, 6-0 in conference play. Green Wave looking to give them their first loss of the season. So got some baseball to go on the American Digital Network.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
8-1, bottom of the seventh inning here at Greerfield Turchin Stadium in New Orleans. Gus Kattengill, Ron Sroboda with you. Game one of the three-game series. Your quick scoreboard. See the fans enjoying a beautiful evening here in New Orleans in and around the American Conference. East Carolina leading UCF 7-5 in the eighth. Houston leading on the road at Memphis 10-3 in the sixth. And it's Cincinnati and USF right now doing battle. Ron will give you that score as soon as it loads up here. As all the weekend series for baseball getting going. On a Thursday, Easter weekend, Big Country is what they call them here in New Orleans. Hunter Williams will lead off the bottom of the seventh inning.
Yeah, well, Big Country's got a 4.0 average academically and is heading for, if he doesn't go on and play professional baseball, which I think he will get a chance.
9-3 is that score, by the way, Cincy in Florida. First pitch swinging, fouled off.
He'll go on to medical school. He hopes to. This is a new pitcher, Wallace. You mentioned it. He's a freshman.
So he replaces Trevor Holmes.
Well, this is when a game gets, I don't want to say out of hand, but when it gets stretched out like this, you tend to go to a different bunch of guys. You want to see some guys. You know, you're starting to develop already. Get some arms in there that normally won't get to pitch. This is a fastball slider kind of guy. Throws from that kind of three-quarter arm slot.
Right.
From Methuen, Massachusetts. Methuen.
I don't think Trevor Holmes in that one inning. It was a 1-2-3 inning. Hits or walks in his three at batter's face. See how that one tails away there for Wallace. Eight to one here in the bottom of the seventh. Hunter Williams, one of the two players for Tulane coming into the series batting 300.
Wallace's 10th appearance of the year, all of them out of the pen.
Other pitch that stays well away. Two balls, two strikes. Tomorrow night, 6:30 first pitch Central Time, 7:30 over on the East Coast for game two of the series. The pitching matchups on that here in a second as Williams pops that one up. And foul, giving chase. Lambrecht. And Fieldstein.
If you pop Feldstein out in foul ground here at Turchin Stadium, you got bad luck. And why I say that is the stands are so close to the field. There just isn't a whole lot of foul ground. So if you pop up in play in foul ground, it's a lot harder to hit here. When I was playing way back in that other century, we played out in the biggest foul ground we ever had was out in Oakland, the Oakland Alameda Coliseum. It just went forever, foul ground.
And you could,
if you could run a little bit as a left fielder or right fielder, you could chase them a long way and get some outs. Should have been in the stands.
Big swing and a miss there on the 3-2 pitch, and Wallace will sit down. Hunter Williams, the wave first baseman here in the bottom of the seventh inning for out number one. We'll bring up the designated hitter, Jarrett DeHart.
Just lasered that heater over the outside edge.
Had so much gas there, you saw the center field camera jerk a little. Because of the heat.
The heat came off that thing. That's right.
The trail.
Here's DeHart. A couple of Ks and a ground out to second base for a guy that's been swinging the bat pretty good for the Green Wave.
So the wind continues to gust out there in center field. You can see the flags. We're in center.
It stayed pretty much constant, you know, out.
It really has been. Pitch down low. Two balls, no strikes.
Little change up. You know, you'll see right-handers want to use that change up against the left-hander. It's a ball that can fade kind of away from them if you have one. Good pitch. Very effective.
See Wallace going to rosin bag there. Has it been very damp tonight? 75.
Stuff. And a pretty good idea what he's doing.
We touched at the top of the broadcast here, Ron, that this was going to be a team that's hitting well and a team that's been pitching well. And you've seen that really, other than some wacky things that happen in that third inning as Wallace strikes out the side there. Two strikeouts in the inning for Wallace. Top of the eighth inning coming up, six out left for the Huskies on the American Digital Network.
We are America. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
8-1 is your score. The Tulane Green Wave, each team with eight hits. The Huskies with that lone Aaron Ron Strobot. If you're just joining us or if you're just checking in on Twitter or social media going, well, wow, what happened in this game? There was really one inning. You saw the relief pitching by the Huskies there, Trevor Holmes and Jacob Wallace shutting down Tulane. And the Green Wave really only got anything going in that one inning. And you mentioned it was two outs, seemed like nothing going on. And then bases loaded. The pop-up that was dropped by Anthony Prado, well, he never saw it. It fell behind him. Three runs came in there, and that was really the inning. Other than that, it hasn't been an offensive performance by the Green Wave.
Yeah, it should be a 3-1 game, and we should, you know, feeling a little, I don't want to say white knuckles, but a long way from it being a blowout.
Lusky back out there on the mound for the Green Wave, and Feldstein leading off for the Huskies here. Up ahead, two balls, one strike here in the top of the eighth. So six outs remain for the Huskies. Next pitch out there, the glove pop. And again, home plate umpire Doug Williams. Not an inch off that plate. It's got across the plate.
Lusky in his second inning of work.
Both pitchers have been like that, too, for Kate and Bjornjeld. The two starters fouled straight back there. Full count now. They never really did get a lot of off the plate either way, low, high, whatever.
Well, what's funny.
Doug Williams has called it even for both teams the entire game, a tight plate. That's lined, shot into the bullpen. Nobody there.
We had one three-up, three-down inning by Tim Kate in his five innings of work. Really good left-hander for them, who just had that inning from...
It was one inning.
The dark side. And otherwise, he showed you a lot of gumption. And he showed you a lot of gumption after that.
Feldstein lays off the high fastball inside and will get a walk. 0-for-3 going into that at-bat. Make his way over to first base. Leadoff walk, and again, it's, you know, UConn's going to look at this game later on and go, we had a runner on the last, what, four of the last five innings have had a runner on every inning other than the seventh, which is the only 1-2-3 inning in the game so far for them, as now up to the plate is designated hitter Tyler Nesda. First pitch is a ball, as Paul Gaza wants to slow things down and have a brief conversation with Selesky.
I was saying last week, midweek here, they played Bryant and had an 8-run sixth inning against them. UConn gave up 8, and they had a couple of errors and couldn't get anybody out. Just couldn't get anybody out. A bunch of base hits, a couple of errors. And so they've seen a big inning happen for a team that doesn't seem like they should be giving up big innings like that.
As the sees a high strike there, a few moans from the folks here at Greer Field. Again, Doug Williams, it's a specific plate that he is calling tonight, both pitchers.
I think he's called a good
strike zone. You want consistency one way or another. That ball definitely high. So Selesky.
He's walked 3-0. He's walked 14 guys in 36 plus innings. So command hasn't been a big problem for him.
Strike down the middle there. The count moves to 3-1. Leadoff walk, Isaac Feldstein. Ron, maximize each pitch, each at-bat here with only 6 outs left, down 7. 3-1, swung on, popped up. Shallow right field coming on is Grant Witherspoon, and he makes the grab for out number 1.
That's a pretty good pitch where you were behind in the count. And probably one, if the hitter had it to do again, he wouldn't swing at it. That was tough location, down and away, but he popped it up the right, and you kind of bail out a pitcher in a difficult at-bat that's in your favor.
Bring up Troy Stefanski, singled in his first plate appearance. He came in for John Topa. Came in for him in the sixth inning. First pitch to him is inside corner for a strike.
The 220 hitter went up there to hit and promptly hit one hard for a base hit. Leading off as a pinch hitter back in the sixth inning. Oh, that's hit.
Pulls this one deep to right center field. Still going. Not going to be able to get it. Is Grant Witherspoon off the wall. Fields it over around third. Fieldstein's going to be held up. So he gets the third, but a double there by Troy Stefanski. So off the bench run. He's had 2 hits, and he got a hold of that one, as you can see. Witherspoon going back. He just was not going to get it as it one hopped just past 370 on the wall there.
Spoon with a pretty good arm gets it in here, but an instant rally off the bat.
And I mentioned
Stefanski
there being smart with everything. You're down 7. They did not send Feldstein there.
No. Couldn't take a chance there. You're down by 7 runs.
Playing for the big inning. Runners on 2nd and 3rd. 1 out. Up to the bat is Chris Winkle. 0-for-3 on the evening. First baseman for the Huskies.
Bullpen for Tulane starts to get busy.
First pitch to him is high and outside. Ron, here's a situation. Chase, a freshman, getting a little bit of a trouble. How does he react? How does he handle this? He has a 7-run lead, but you see Tulane with 2 pitchers on the bullpen. Comes back with a strike. Swing and a miss by Winkle.
When he's missing, though, it looks like he's missing up. That means sometimes you're not bending over and getting into the pitch.
Base hit here by the Huskies. Make it 8-3. Start a big inning going here. Strike down the middle there.
That's a good pitch.
Right, for the Tulane side, you're going, you don't want crooked numbers with a big run. A big lead that you do, and if you're UConn, just put a couple of crooked numbers on there. You're running low on outs, though, down on 5, but you want some crooked numbers.
That was a hitter's pitch right there, right down Broadway.
Here's the 1-2 inside. It'll be a ball. Gazzo liked it, though. You saw him point back over to Selesky.
See, he gets the sign from the bench, and then the references on that pad he wears on his arm.
Infield deep here, Ron.
college baseball. The coaches call all the pitches.
Here's a 2-2 outside for a ball. Things will get real interesting.
It's funny. Selesky's thrown some balls up that just look like he's just not committed to. Not getting, leaning over, getting into it.
Perhaps a mound visit on a walk here. Here's a 3-2, and it swung on and fouled towards the back. It's interesting baseball. You said game of inches. It's also a game of pitches, too, right? If Selesky, let's say, gets Winkle here on a strikeout, things feel differently. If it's a walk, it's probably a mound visit, right? I mean, it's,
for the most
it's a
part,
difference.
You know, almost always you're one pitch from getting out of a mess if you make the pitch.
Well, here's a 3-2, and it's a fastball down the middle. Did he take something off it? Almost a changeup. It was down the middle as Chris Winkle swings through it there.
Really?
Bonner's right down the middle.
He got under it. Now, that's that four-seamer sometimes. We talked about it. You get a little rotation on it. You don't have to throw it through a brick wall. It just doesn't come down. They call it, sometimes they call that the invisiball. It's like, it looks like you ought to mash it, but you don't.
A huge strikeout there, and for the Huskies, down to four outs. It's Jack Lambert. Swings first pitch and fouls it over to the right.
You get away with a pitch like that, you know, you got to be asking yourself, why am I trying to be cute going in and out? Just throw it right there.
UConn still a hit away.
Clearly, it's not that easy.
Getting back into this. Got to pick up the runners on second and third. That's Isaac Feldstein and Troy Stefanski. But a rocket double over to right center field.
He did. That one had a chance.
One ball, one strike, two outs here in the top of the eighth inning. Here's the 1-1, and it's high. There you go again. He's
looked like he got into that one a little bit, though. You know, I mean, really let her go.
And you see him trying to rub on what would be dirt on the mound, and you just saw the sand come up. It's an artificial mound.
There is sand in it, but you're right.
It's a habit thing, too. You're used to doing that. Swung on and blooped over to right or left field, rather, and that is going to be a hit. Two runs will score as it is a two RBI double by Lambrecht. So we said, Ron, you're just a hit away, really, from putting up a crooked number and trying to get back into this thing.
Well, it goes to show you can call the same pitch, but you don't necessarily throw the same pitch.
Is it one hopped? Or there in left field.
It was right where he liked it, and he banged it hard up down the left field line, up against the barrier. And very quickly.
And on cue, a pitching change is going to come. Travis Jewett is going to go to the right-hander. So 8-3 is your score. Top of the eighth inning, two outs. The Huskies do have a runner in scoring position. That is Lambrecht over at second. For the Green Wave, we'll tell you who the new pitcher is when we come back. Huskies looking to make a game of it here. Down 5 on the American Digital Network.
We are America. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is Our Backyard.
This is UConn.
So a two-out double by Jack Lambrecht of the UConn Huskies. The second baseman makes it an 8-3 ball game. Gus Cattingill, Ron Svoboda with you. We have a new pitcher.
Burton Schnake. Check it out. It looks an awful lot like it ought to be pronounced Schnake, but it's not. Schnake is from Houston, Texas. He's a freshman. Big kid, too. 6'3", 211. This is his sixth appearance of the year. He did have a start earlier, mostly out of the pen. Fastball, mid-80s. I'm told a pretty good changeup he'll use. There's a slider. Has his breaking pitch in there somewhere.
He will face Keith Krueger, the center fielder for the Huskies. Left-hander versus a right-handed pitcher here. 1-for-3 on the afternoon.
1 2/3 innings for Selesky.
Here's the first pitch. It's a breaking pitch on the outside corner. Called for a strike, and immediately, though, you see Paul Gazzo, the catcher for the Green Wave, Ron, go up there and have a conversation, mix up in perhaps pitches.
It's like
maybe he wanted something else, and the breaking pitch came in.
Fortunately, you caught it. Sometimes when you're crossed up with a fastball, you don't have time to catch it. And, it, you know, you think you caught a curveball, and that fastball dings off your face mask. You're like, I think we better go talk about this.
Here's the 0-1, fastball outside. Selesky, 1 2/3, 2 hits, 2 runs, 2 errors, a walk, and a strikeout. Green Wave pitcher.
Pretty good changeup he'll use against left-handers. It's got some fade. That might have been it.
Kruger looking for RBI number 9 with the base hit. Fastball outside. 2 balls and a strike. Green Wave continue to have 2 pitchers warming up in the bullpen for UConn. They have some arms going as well. 2 arms as well. Here's a 2-1 low and outside for ball 3. Ron, innings can get a bit hairy for teams that are leading if you can't throw strikes.
Yeah, we've got a busy bullpen, a lefty and a righty for Tulane.
And over for UConn. Pitcher there as well. Looks like Sam Napersky. Here's a 3-1. Swung on, ground ball, and it's going to go over to the second baseman. Jake Wilsey picks it up and throws out. Keith Krueger to retire the side, but in the inning, 2 runs on 2 hits, no errors. And 1 left on base. At the end of 8, Tulane 8, UConn 3 on the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
Bottom of the 8th inning, the Tulane Green Wave lead it 8-3. UConn down to 3 outs here. They have a new pitcher as well, and it's Andrew Zapata, a senior right-hand pitcher, Ron Svoboda.
Yeah, he's, say that name to me again.
Andrew Zapata. What's interesting, and the reason why I've said it a couple times, he's wearing Mason Fioli's jersey, and the UConn broadcasters came in and said, by the way, it's not Mason. That is Andrew Sapana, who apparently left his jersey somewhere. That is Andrew, though, not Mason. So he takes to the mound for the UConn Huskies and becomes the fourth pitcher of record on the evening. As for UConn, things started out with...
It's Zapata, though, right?
Yep, Tim Cate, five innings pitched. Trevor Holmes had an inning. Jacob Wallace had an inning, and Andrew Zapata now.
Only his
on the mound.
Second appearance. He started a ball game, and it was a pretty rough outing. Inning and a third, five hits, three runs.
Pinch hitter for the Tulane Green Wave, and that's number four, Sal Gazzo.
Okay, all the Gazzo boys are in here.
First pitch to him. Hit hits him on the inside.
He's going to come in and play shortstop for Hosey.
Sal Gazzo makes his way over to first as the first pitch hits him right on the top of their right foot there from Zapata.
Twin brothers. The Gazzo's twin brothers. The guy catching tonight, Paul and Sal, are twin brothers.
I'll bring up Grant Brown, who's 1-for-3 on the evening. RBIs today as well for Grant, and still that defensive play that no doubt we'll talk about and could turn out to be a very big play in the series. UConn had a run, could have been 2-0 early on, things going their way, and he makes the throwback to second as the Husky was just making the round around second base, but threw behind him and tagged him out before the second run crossed the plate.
At the time, a pretty big run.
Here's the 1-0, and he swings, puts a huge swing on it, but pulls it. And it's going to go foul into somebody's backyard.
The football practice field is over in that direction.
Well, you're hoping it's there, not somebody's backyard,
yeah,
as opposed to the house, a window, or a car.
Yes. I parked over the right field fence.
One ball, one strike here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Zapata.
Oh, curve ball.
Almost had his second hit batsman there, as you see Zach Susie walk out. Ron just kind of got away from him there. Brown tried to slowly get out of the way. Zapata looks over to first. Here's the 2-1. Swung on, popped up. Could be a play. Susie calling forward, and unfortunately just couldn't get the angle on it as the ball started trailing back. Earlier, the wind was blowing that way. You look at the flags now, and it kind of not blowing nearly as much, but it is going back in that direction, left center field.
Well, that ball's always going to have a loop on it, and this is really a ball where the first baseman has to look. He wants it, and the catcher's calling it. You got to call him off.
Yeah, the first baseman would have made an easier play there, and
sure,
that would have been Chris Winkle.
You just have to sound out and get him off it, because that's a tough angle for a catcher to run it down.
Runner going. Two balls, two strikes, and a runner does go, and no throw down there. As Sal, hey, if you're going to put him in, right, why not? I'm stealing a base. I get hit by a ball.
Sure. Look, it's baseball. You don't know how many you need. It's not over yet.
Stolen base by Sal Gasso. Pinch hit for Cody Hosey. Grant Brown here ahead, 3-2. He was going on the pitch. Wasn't a hit and run.
Sal is a incrementally maybe a little better shortstop defensively than Hosey, who's not bad.
Zapata delivers ground ball over the short. Prado goes to third. The throw not in time. As Gazzo gets in under the tag, Prado fielded it cleanly, went straight to third, probably the easiest play instead of coming across and trying to get the lead runner. Good decision for him. The ball looked like it got there in time, but the tag must have been underneath the play.
Yeah, I thought he did a good job of sliding away from the tag. I thought this was a bad base running play. But see where the throw is?
The throw is high and over to the left.
High and
up
away
the line,
from...
yeah. If it's at the base, he's out easily.
Normally, that's a ball you need to see go through, but...
Well, the Wave now have runners on first and third, no out. And now we'll bring up Jake Wilsey. Zapata delivers. First pitch is a ball.
Wilsey, the author of that uncatchable pop-up back in the third inning that busted this game wide open. Two-out pop-up that just didn't get caught.
One ball, no strikes. Runners on first and third.
Then Wilsey scored.
And the pitch is in there for a strike. So Brown over, what, on a fielder's choice.
This is a 4-3 ball game if that ball gets caught.
Yeah.
Now, I know chaos or string theory or chaos theory, you can't change one thing in time without everything else changing. I understand that theory.
Jake Wilsey, one for three on the day. But pickoff attempt to Brown over at first. Looking at the middle infielders for the Huskies, Ron, they're playing for the double play.
Pretty much. We're thinking about Tulane thinking about running. There they go.
And indeed, Brown does go to second, takes the double play out of play. Now I have runners on second and third.
I think that's the whole idea.
As home plate umpire, Doug Williams gets the...
That's a pretty good jump, too. They measure the time it takes a pitcher like Zapata to get it to home plate, how long it takes the catcher to throw. If the numbers look right, you go.
Base hit for Wilsey, could get two. Now the infield in, much different than a pitch ago where everybody was out playing for the double play, and the pitch is in there for a strike. Two balls, two strikes. The infielder's in. Toes just about on the green part of the artificial surface. It plays with your eyes, Ron. I mean, this looks like a beautifully cut field of grass, but it's not. It is an artificial surface. Here's a 2-2. Fastball fouled over to the right side.
I love the effect, and I thought it would look great on television. With the lighting from certain angles, you can see a little bit of a shine off of it. But you also can see on the pitcher's mound, there's a box, a landing area where you throw from, where you can remove that area if it gets worn and replace it.
Here's a 2-2 once again, and it's high over the catcher's head, but it comes right back. So no chance to advance.
Yeah, this is one of the peculiarities when that ball, if that gets cleanly by the catcher and hits that backstop, you can't be going from third base. It'll come right back to him, and you can tag yourself out right there.
It came right back, yeah.
Yeah, catcher makes the play without flipping it to anybody. That's amazing. So you have to be careful about that.
Here we go again. Zapata delivers, and it's fouled off over to the right side.
Good fastball away. He's got that breaking ball he can use and a changeup.
No outs here in the bottom of the eighth inning. Tulane had a big third inning. Seven runs came across. A lone run for the Huskies came in the top of the second. 8-3 to score. Here's the pitch. Swing and a miss and a huge strikeout for Zapata. Big pitch.
Fastball up and in. Out of the zone, Wilsey chases it.
Big pitch by the senior there.
Good fastball with some giddy up on it.
High and inside.
Yeah, that's
those are always the hardest to lay off. You know you shouldn't swing,
yes,
and
absolutely.
You still swing.
Well, you know, you don't have a lot of time to think about
right. It.
It looks big. The ball looks big, but it
beautiful
is.
Beautiful pitch by the senior. Now up is Paul Gazzo. Same pitch, same result. A swing and a miss.
Yeah, hard to get to that. It's a four-seamer, it would appear. Thrown right over the top. Yeah, that got good carry on it, and it looks large.
So Gazzo during the middle of the swing went, no.
A desultory sort of effort. Because halfway into his swing, he went, I shouldn't be doing this.
Infield still in for the Huskies. Here's the 0-1 fastball high and outside this time.
Usually if a pitcher sees you interested in that, or the manager, or I should say the head coach making the calls, Jim Pender, you'll throw him some more, see if he'll swing at him.
Zapata with the 1-1. Swung on and missed, including the bat, which goes flying into the Tulane dugout.
Usually when you get more distance on your bat than the ball, it's not a good thing.
Ron, I thought it was a cool evening and the humidity hadn't hit. There goes the bat right out of Gazzo's hands into the dugout. Well, if you look at Zapata in the jersey,
that never happened.
There's some perspiration on the Huskies pitcher.
Get a little coaching here.
What are you saying here? Hold on to the bat?
Travis Jewett, yeah.
A full John Madden-ism there. You know, you have a better chance of hitting the ball with the bat in your hands. That's my...
Something sober, because Travis Jewett and his coaching staff are a good bunch here at Tulane. They are brand new. Travis Jewett, a first-time Division I head coach. He coached in junior college up in Washington State in the beginning.
1-2 pitch.
Oh,
this time fouled straight back off the catcher, Zach Susi.
And another...
He's going to take a few moments to gather himself as he is...
Hope he's all right.
Little daze as that ball...
That thing hit square in the mask.
Yes, it went straight back into the mask there.
Mm. You know, keeps you from breaking stuff, but I'll tell you what.
Ball,
watch the slow-mo. Bonk right in the face. That just jars your head. Your brain just feels like something big hit you.
They say catchers are a tougher breed. You gotta be, as you can see. It's a fastball right down.
Yeah.
Gazzo's on it. Just gets right on underneath the ball, and it hits almost on the left part.
Yeah.
Upper left part of that mask. Because he was starting to turn away on the face, too.
Not a good idea either.
No.
Boy.
You've seen some catchers, major league level, even college, go with the hockey mask. This is the old school, right? With just the batting helmet backwards.
I've heard some people tell me, though, that hockey mask is a little rougher on your head when you take one in the face than this old style with the padding.
Right.
I've heard that.
It's just a mask over a batting helmet backwards.
Yeah.
One ball, two strikes, no out, or one out here, rather, and it's lifted over the left field. Stefanski has it. He will throw it in, play at the plate in time, and he's going to get him. Gazzo throwing out a beautiful play by Stefanski.
Yes.
Who has two hits and then comes in and makes a fantastic throw from left field. Look at it. Measures it up. Gets the Green Wave batter out at home.
That's a great throw. Boom.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
UConn Huskies down to their final three outs. 8-3 is your score. UConn 3-10-1 on the box score. The Green Wave, 8 runs, 8 hits, no errors. When you take a look at how you got there again, that third inning coming up here after the broadcast, Ron Svoboda will make his way down to the field. We'll speak with the winning manager and a player of the game as well. So stay with us here in the American Digital Network. As we'll have baseball with you, obviously, the rest of the season, the rest of the way. As we get into the second inning of work for Burton. Shanky's first pitch is in there for a strike. Anthony Prado, the shortstop for the Huskies, at the plate. It's popped up. Calling it is Gazzo, and he makes the catch. One out in the inning. Gazzo got the helmet off and the mask. Was able to make the play. We'll bring up Willie on. 2-for-4 on the day for Willie. Schnocki delivers inside and low. And tomorrow, 6:30 Central, first pitch between the two teams. Game two of the three-game series. 11 a.m. Central on Saturday. Second pitch a little further inside by Schnocki. Two balls, no strikes here, one away in the top of the ninth inning. Third pitch for a ball. Yana walk already in the fifth inning. On deck, Zach Soucy took a ball off the mask just a half inning ago in a four-pitch walk. Send Willie on over to first base. Tulane with a chance to add to their lead last inning. Unable to get a run in. Had a chance at an inning to break it open a bit. UConn able to get away with it. Double play. In play for the Green Wave and would get them out of the inning and win the game. Over to second, stealing and in time is Yon. So he takes that out of play for Tulane. So Tulane will still need to get two other outs. Can't do it via the double play there as the throw was laid in also. Salgazzo playing shortstop. Didn't field it cleanly either. Schnocki delivers high again for another ball. Pair of pitchers in the bullpen for the Green Wave in case this inning... It's Harry for the Wave. Head coach Travis Jewett ready to go there if needed. Looking to see if Schnocki can get out of the inning here. Susie looking for a hit. He's 0-for-3 on the day and sees another ball low for 2-0. A ground out, a walk, a pop up the first baseman, and a put out 1-3. Rolled it back to the pitcher back in the seventh inning. Again, he was one of our key players to look at as Gazzo goes over to the mound to make sure they're on the same page, he and Schnocki. Mentioned Susie came into the game, leading the way and playing very well for the Huskies. Base hit could make it 8-4. Three balls, no strikes. Schnocki delivers, and it is low. Rather, it's 3-1 now. The 3-1 outside. Whoa. And a strike is called there. Looked outside. And that is over the white part of the right batter's box. Doug Williams liked it, and now a time is going to be called. As Susie called time right before Schnocki delivered the pitch. Three balls, two strikes. Doug Williams, the home plate umpire, been calling it tight, not been giving a lot of corners this evening. He gave one there. See if Zuzi can come through for the Huskies. Three balls, two strikes. Here's the pitch. Swung on up the middle. Positioned perfectly as Salgazzo. And he will deliver to first for the second out of the inning. He barely moved. The Wave are one out away. As you see, the ball basically hit right at Sal Gazzo, who pinch hit earlier for Cody Ozy. Wave an out away from trying to take the first game of the series. First pitch down the middle to Isaac Feldstein. Right fielder for the Huskies. Your scoreboard on the American Conference as well. And Ron Sobota will have the winning manager and a player of the game when we come back following the game. Huskies trying to play another run. Here's the pitch inside for a ball. Feldstein 0 for 3 for the evening. Ground out to short, ground out to third, and a strikeout. He did walk in the eighth, though. Over at third base is Willie Yon. Here's the pitch, swung on and fouled. Nice play over there. Third base coach getting a round of applause. The home crowd here at Greerfield Turchin Stadium. One ball, two strikes, top of the ninth, two outs. Here's the pitch inside, and it actually hit him on the elbow. So Feldstein will make his way to first base. We'll have runners on first and third. Bringing up Tyler Nesda, designated hitter. 0 for 4 today. As you saw, Isaac Feldstein taking it on the left elbow there, and appears to be Travis Jewett, and it is. So we'll have a pitching change. As Coach Jewett will go once again to the mound. We'll let you know who the new Tulane pitcher is. Huskies down to their final out. We'll have that when we return on the American Digital Network.
We are American. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
UConn trying to make some noise here down to their final out, top of the ninth inning. They are down 8-3. Robert Price, the new pitcher for the Tulane Green Wave. The freshman has pitched 10 in the third inning, giving up 13 hits, 13 runs. 12 of them are earned. His ERA 10.45 as he faces Tyler Nesda. First pitch to him on the outside corner is in there for a strike. Nesda, as we said, 0 for 4 on the day. Did get a walk. Rather, that was the batter right before. True for 4 on the evening. Pitch on the outside is a ball. One ball, one strike. At third is Willie Yon. And at second is Isaac Feldstein. Got hit by a pitch. Swing and a miss. by Nesda, who's trying to make it 8-6 with that swing. High fastball, couldn't catch up to it. If he did, could have been a three-run homer. Down to the final strike, one ball, two strikes. Robert Price delivers. Popped up inside the infield. Sal Gazzo calling it and makes the catch. The Tulane Green Wave will take game one of the three-game series against the UConn Huskies. The final score of 8-3. Won't go anywhere when we come back. Ron Svoboda will have head coach Travis Jewett. He will also speak with the player of the game. So your final score is 8-3. Post-game coverage continues next on the American Digital Network.
We are America. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
We are America. The conference of opportunity. The opportunity to chase dreams. The opportunity to make your mark and change the game. Because that's power. We are power.
This is a classroom.
This is a lab.
This is a study break.
This is family.
This is our backyard.
This is UConn.
When it comes to learning at Tulane University, there are no boundaries. Architects and scientists in New Orleans, doctors and public health experts in Africa, history and language scholars in Latin America, legal students and professors in Europe, business students in Asia. Tulaneans are all over the globe, and the world is their oyster. We've got that and a lot more right here at Tulane University.
Final score this evening at Greerfield Turchin Stadium, the Tulane Green Wave, 8-3 over the UConn Huskies. Tulane improves to 16-18 overall on the season, 5-2 in conference play. UConn 19-12 now overall, 6 and finally the 1. Started out the season 6-0 in conference play. Coming up shortly, we'll speak with Ron Svoboda. He will have head coach Travis Jewett and a couple of players of the game. We'll have that here shortly. Winning pitcher for the Tulane Green Wave is Sam Bjornjeld. 3-2 now on the season. He went 6 innings, 8 hits, 1 run, 1 earned. 2 walks, 3 strikeouts in the game. The loss goes to Tim Cate. Drops to 3-2 on the season. 5 innings pitched for him. 8 hits, 8 runs. 3 of them were earned. Remember, that big bases loaded error by the shortstop was given Muzz a hit, but Anthony Prado lost it in the lights. And he gave two walks and five strikeouts in that. You look at the final box, UConn, 3 runs, 10 hits, and an error. Tulane, 8 runs, 9 hits, and no errors. As we go down on the field to Ron Svoboda. Ron, take it away.
Yeah, we're talking to Hunter Hope, and this is a team that's hit a few home runs this year, and that big 7-run third inning had nothing to do with home runs. You had a walk in that, Hunter Hope, but all of a sudden, a game that looked like it was going to be close, Tim Cade, a pretty good left-handed pitcher, all of a sudden there's 7 on the board. How did it feel in the dugout?
I mean, we were really confident in the dugout. We saw him last year. We just try to not do too much, just kind of just see the fastball and just try to lay off the off speed.
You knew you were coming up against a pretty tough left-hander. You look at his numbers. He struck out a lot of guys. Tulane's been a team that struck out a few times. It looked like a collision of, of K's coming.
Yeah, I mean, he's a really good pitcher. But we just try not to do too much and just try to just see it deep and just try to just react to his stuff, lay off the off speed, like I said, and just try to do what we can do.
Would it be fair to say under a new head coach, Travis Jewett comes in, you got a bunch of senior hitters this year who are struggling early on, and maybe you could put yourself in that category. And then all of a sudden, there's an awakening. You hit one today as about as hard as you can hit it. But there's been an awakening of these seniors, and the offense has shown it.
Yeah, I mean, we've been playing really well the past few conference games. We've been hitting really well as a team. And being older guys, I mean, we struggled early. But, I mean, right now, I feel like as a whole offensive staff, like we're hitting very well right now.
Yeah, I'm thinking back to when you came out of the chute with a 2-12 streak, and I don't know if anybody was thinking conference playoffs or what's going to happen here, but that seems like another season almost with the way you guys have put it together.
Yeah, I mean, we just put that aside, and basically once conference started, we just tried to basically a whole new season, put that aside and just start right now.
Obviously, UConn coming in here 6-0 in the conference early on, but the team to beat. So that had your attention.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they were 6-0. We were 4-2 in second place. Like, we knew we could compete with anybody.
Well, this is the team, and all of a sudden has like 36 bombs and looks like they can swing the bat. You showed it tonight, and really congratulations to you and the rest of the Greenway.
Appreciate it. Thank you very much.
You got it. That's Hunter Hope. And right now the coach is doing his little press conference, so I'll throw it back to you, Gus.
Yeah, Ron, we will hear from head coach Travis Jewett here in a second. You mentioned Hunter Hope there. He was 2-for-3 on the day, had a hit and an RBI. Also with multiple RBIs, Hunter Williams for the Green Wave. He was 1-of-4 for 2 RBIs. Jake Wilsey, the second baseman, 1-for-4 with 3 RBI. Again, that was that ball that he popped up to the shortstop, Anthony Prado. Lost it in the lights immediately, and that helped lead to that 7-run inning here in that third, and that was really the big difference. Again, the big play, though, UConn jumped out early 1-0, and here it is. Grant Brown throwing back at the time didn't seem like a big one, and here's the big play. Wilsey, it falls behind Prado. 7 runs run in there, and that led to an 8-3 win. When we come back, head coach Travis Jewett with Ron Svoboda on the American Digital Network.